These niggas ain't bigger than me. These niggas ain't Nas, ain't Jigga to me. These niggas ain't M, they ain't 50 to me. You ain't Pun, you ain't Pop, you ain't Biggie to me. These niggas ain't Crips, they ain't 60s to me. These niggas ain't Bloods, they ain't dripping with me. Niggas talking that shit about a new generation, man. Fuck these niggas, I slash your fucking faces. You niggas ain't so shit, not an album or a rock. Pussy nigga putting rings on my old bitch. Dick down the throat ass niggas, old hoe ass niggas. Happy cause you went gold ass niggas. These niggas ain't spitting with me, you ain't sicker than me. Fuck out my section, you ain't sitting with me. This for very important people, it's clear that we not equal. Clear you niggas faggots, I'm the Black Marshall Mathers. Like yin yin yang on a motherfucker. Who needs Hulk Hogan when you got Sting on this motherfucker? Less than 5 albums, kiss the ring on this motherfucker. California throne and I'm the king on this motherfucker. I don't wanna hear it. Weak ass lyrics, crying on the hook, thinking we gon' feel it. Old lost ass niggas, voice crack when you talk ass nigga, rolling blunts for the boss ass niggas. I came in with Ye, Jeezy, and boss ass niggas. Your freshman cover a whole bunch of soft ass niggas. Tampon lyricists, evacuate the premises. Mute BET ciphers, cause I don't wanna hear that shit. May you rest in piss, you fuck niggas. A Frank Ocean, go ahead and fuck these fuck niggas. Yeah, they fuck niggas. Ain't no 3 stacks in your class, so take your top 10 spot and shove it up your ass, bitch boy. Niggas already fucked your bitch, you bitch boy. And every time you kiss on that hoe, you suck my dick, you bitch boy. And when you buy that hoe a bag, that bitch carry my bricks, you bitch boy.
Look a here, look a here, look a here, look a here. Man, ETM Hotel, Rennie, Sean, welcome in peace. My name is Sean. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in to Science with Sean. Lately, I've been on this whole comedic thing. It's what the pseudos like to throw their name out, comedic, comedic, comedic. But now I've been dealing with the Remitch the past couple of days. Just, you know, trying to air out some stuff a little bit and expose people to some stuff. But along the way, somebody did a presentation and trying to educate me on something that they know very little about. We're going to get into it and we're going to do what we need to do. Now, it's already been told to me that she don't want to tune in to today's episode. She got the link. And she got about 1,100 clicks. I ain't gonna say no views, cause you got 1,100 clicks, but you ain't got no likes, no 100 likes, 200 likes. You got 10 on your video, which mean they clicked on and clicked off real quick. You feel me? Or you just sitting there been doing it all day, clicking on. That's what you've been doing all day. But before we get started, I want to bring people up to speed. So a few days ago, she was in the chat. She was arguing with Sutek. Che was in the chat. You remember she came on the panel and she was arguing with them on the panel when she came on here. As you can see, she right there on the panel. Craig on the panel as well. But in the chat, she makes the comment, Maat is a belief system. It's a religion. Maat. And then she says, Maat is a goddess. But prior to that, you know what I'm saying? They were trying to get some straightening with her early. She just, her ego, her attitude or something was just in the way. She's like, my ain't a belief system and concept of balance. So, you know, they were trying to give her some, you know, straighten it out. But she just was consistent. Maat is a goddess and the laws of Maat is a religion. So we got it right here. Maat is a belief system. It's a religion. You know what I'm saying? We got the other video right here. She comes in and she starts saying all kind of weird stuff, even bringing up astrology and my eye, but y'all don't talk about that. See what I'm saying? She's trying to cover for her belief in astrology. Now, when she comes out the side of her face the next time, she started trying to clip a little videos or whatever, and she pointed in this direction. Now, I told her not to do this. But before we get started, though, I do need y'all to like the show, share the show, tell a friend, we're live, man. I know it's more people that's interested in what's about to go down. Also, in the description of this video, I leave you a shitload of resources. Excuse me. And this is pretty much not only for y'all that's in the chat, but for the people that she aligns herself with. I leave a shitload of resources because, you know, after having a conversation with Brother Asar and stuff like that, talking about a few things that we talked about previously, there was some straightening that need to be had toward the approach. So I didn't want to approach it and make people think that what I'm about to do today would be biased. You know what I mean? I know how to eliminate bias, focus on what I need to focus on and deal with what I need to deal with, but at the same time, show them where they're wrong and correct them in their mistakes. I just stay wrong and just leave it at you're wrong. You don't know what you're talking about, but show them, demonstration beats conversation, and then provide them with the information that would allow them to edify themselves if they took the time to do so. So you're going to see what is also in this presentation, all my sources on each slide, and at the end of the presentation. But before I do anything, for anyone that's unfamiliar with her response, we're going to take a look at her actual response. And I do want to say peace to Indigenous Black Man, Brother Sute, Keenan, Pure Black Marlon, Brother Mathis, EIE, and all the other people that have not said a word but are reviewing the stream. Peace to all of you. And those of you who may straddle in here a little bit late, I don't know if anyone else is on or live or anything like that, but it is what it is. Time to do, we're going to get to it. What else, Sister Juju? What's good? So, as my screen is still sharing, I'm going to go ahead and pull it up. Now, look, 1171 on the views, only 10 likes. You know, the 10 people that probably liked it are the 10 people that I piss off the most.
Hello, I am Denise, and today I am going to do a presentation about Maya. It's about basically the fact that I said that it was a religion. The introduction. And I'm dealing with those statements right now. I'm dealing with that. One second, let me make sure that this is working before I continue.
Let it work up to
okay.
Yeah, there we go.
So I was on a channel called Science Sean or Science with Sean.
You know the name of it.
And I made some statements that I'm going to get into in a moment. That channel, it's a good channel if you like science, if you like to deal with science, if you like to learn about new scientific discoveries. Oh, scientific discoveries, science. They love science. Okay, so me making this statement on there was kind of big. And so I'm doing a presentation to explain what it is that I was saying. Okay, I'm talking right now because I was trying to make sure that I shared it to everybody. I didn't make a big like announcement about it because this is my first presentation, so I was like, oh, I don't know. But I do want to get this out here because I feel like people kind of romanticize Egypt and things a lot, and we don't want to do that. Yeah. Okay, one second.
This presentation is not long, ladies and gentlemen. So bear with her with her technical difficulties earlier on, and she's going to get straight to the bill. Just have a little patience. She's working her way into it.
Okay. All right. 42 laws of my religious. So we're going to deal with the statements that I made while on this show. As you can see here, I'm on the show, and I'm also typing in the background. So we see they're kind of, they're circled. So one of them, I said, Ma'at is a belief system. Okay. And so I may have been typing and listening on the show and just typing really fast. So I'm like, I don't think Ma'at, the word Ma'at itself, the goddess itself, is a belief system. Right? So that I put an X on that one because that's not, you know, it is, I did type that, but it's not actually like what I meant by it. Right. I said Ma'at is a goddess, and the laws of Ma'at is the religion. It takes you on that journey to where your heart is weighed by Anubis. So unpacked, what I was trying to say is that Egyptians were religious. They're polytheistic to be exact. The people would have belief without really much action if it wasn't for these 42 negative confessions of Ma'at. They create kind of a moral code for the people to live by. So if you follow this code, it will positively affect your afterlife, which is religious to me. So we're going to see what was said on there. One second.
We have people in Africa, these African Americans are making these things something that they're not supposed to be because of the way they are trying to worship, practice these underworld texts as a religion, similar to Christianity and all these other things. So when I say something like this has nothing to do with religion, I'm telling you the pseudoscientific community in New York, for real,
So, Sean P. Oh, it wasn't. Okay, if it was echo, I'm gonna replay it. I'm sorry.
And to worship people in Africa, these African Americans are making these things something that they're not supposed to be because of the way they are trying to worship, practice these underworld texts as a religion, similar to Christianity and all these other things. So when I say something like this has nothing to do with a religion, I'm telling you the pseudoscientific community in New York, for real, I ain't lying to you. And those people, those commanders.
So you're saying that the dead for this, because it's the dead.
Those
right?
Declarations have birth in their mind. It's the funerary text that they're reading, is what I'm trying to say.
Yes, but it has to do with their afterlife, right?
Listen to me. Ain't nobody in America tell you how the remit you have people in.
So Sean P claimed that several African Americans made the 42 laws of Ma'at part of a religion and that it was never part of one. As if these funerary texts were not part of a belief that the soul or spirit would be subjected to judgment and go forward to either suffer forever or into a paradise. What is religion? There is so many different definitions of religion. We have religion, the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods, a particular system of faith and worship. Dictionary.com says a set of beliefs concerning the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe, especially when considered the creation of a superhuman agency or agencies, usually involving devotional and ritual observances, and often containing a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. Wikipedia says that religion is usually defined as a social cultural system of designated behaviors and practices, morals, beliefs, worldviews, texts, sanctified places, prophecies, ethics, or organizations that generally relates humanity to supernatural, transcendental, and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. Merriam-Webster says that religion is a personal set of institutionalized system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices. The service and worship of God or the supernatural, commitment or devotion to religious faith or observance, the state of a religious cause, principle, or system of beliefs held to with order and faith. So these are all these definitions of religion. So we want to make like some qualifying markers. So I made qualifying markers of religion based on all of those definitions. Belief in or concern with an afterlife or soul or spirit. Presence of theism. There is monotheism, polytheism, all kinds of theisms. But they're all referencing a deity or some kind of supernatural force. Offerings or sacrifices, holy places, temples, lands, or building, holy place, rituals, and worship of some kind, whether it's venerating the ancestors, mature obedience to deities. Ma'at, who's right here with her feather, refers to the ancient Egyptian concepts of truth, balance, order, harmony, law, morality, and justice. Ma'at was also the goddess who personified these concepts. She was depicted with wings or as a woman with the ostrich feather on her head. This feather was said to be used in the ceremony of the weighing of the heart. In this ceremony, the decedent's heart is weighed against her feather for judgment. Ma'at, this is a quote, Ma'at is a comprehensive construct that existed through ancient Egyptian civilization. In its cosmological sense, Ma'at is the principle of order that informs the creation of the universe. In its religious sense, Ma'at is a goddess or nature representing order or balance. Last, in its philosophical sense, Ma'at is a moral and ethical principle that all Egyptians were expected to embody in their daily actions towards family, community, nation, environment, and God. Ma'at's role in the Duat. Egyptians believed that the soul was in the heart, which is why they left the heart in while they removed every other organ in their meticulous burial rituals. The Egyptian Book of the Dead, Papyrus of Ani, gives a full depiction of a soul's journey through this underworld. The Duat is the beginning of the journey. The negative confessions forms part of spell 125 of the Book of the Dead. It was intended to be recited by the deceased when they entered the Hall of Judgment and stood face to face, first of all with Osiris, and then Osiris backed up by a further 42 other divine judges, all of whom the deceased had to name. They had to make a statement asserting their purity and worthiness as their heart was weighed against the feather of Maat. These statements consisted of them confirming that they were not guilty of a range of evil deeds. If the decedent's heart is lighter than a feather on the scale, it means they lived a righteous life or balanced life, and they continued to the Aru, which is also known as the Field of Reeds. If it was heavier, they lived a sinful life, and the goddess Amit devoured their heart, leaving the soul to wander in the Duat forever. Oh, one second. This here was part of the papyrus, but it's part of the judges. Those 42 judges are seen on here. So, just let you know. Maat in society. Maat became a symbol of balance, truth, and order. People would try to honor the basic principles defined by Maat as they would be judged for it in the afterlife. Although the negative confessions cannot be canonical, it is because the journey is personal. However, the principles are the same, but how the person chose to exude those principles may be different in life. The veneration of other deities present in the culture were protected by principles of Maat, making her an important force in keeping the society together as a people. It was a practice for the pharaohs of Egypt to make a sacrifice to her upon ascending to the throne by presenting Maat to the gods, by offering a small image of her, like statue, little. She was little anyway. In doing so, the king was asking for help in maintaining divine balance in his rule. If the king cannot achieve balance and promote harmony, then it was a clear sign that he was not fit to rule. Egyptians partook in nature worship and anthropomorphism. Nature worship is worshiping spirits that are considered behind the natural phenomenon visible through nature. Anthropomorphism is attaching human characteristics or behaviors to things that are not human, such as gods or inanimate objects. Maat not only brought order from chaos, she also regulated the stars and the seasons. These are some of the 40, these are the 42 confessions of Ani. This is from the Papyrus of Ani, the Egyptian Book of the Dead, translated by E.A. Wallace Budge back in the day. But some of these are like, you know, it's hell to a god. And then, you know, they're saying like, I have not cursed a god. I have not stolen. I have not slain cattle belonging to God. I haven't eaten the cakes that were offered to other gods. So this is basically just like an ethical, you know, standard thing that you haven't done, you know, these things in life. But I just wanted to show you like the 42 negative confessions. I'm not reading them all to you, but you know, they're there. So for the Maat claim, the qualifier, do they have a belief or a concern with the afterlife? Yes. The Duat and the Aru is their afterlife. That's where the soul or spirit goes. And, you know, they can travel to the Aru if they go through the Maat ritual in the afterlife and they pass. They are found to be not living a sinful life. Is it a presence of theism? Yes, it's polytheism. And Maat is a goddess. Offerings and sacrifices, she expected.
Hey, real quick, I just want to stop it. Denise, I want to say this while I'm on your video. These people don't think that their soul or spirit goes somewhere else. They believe they go. They believe that they go. Not no soul or their spirit. You're imposing your worldview from a theistic perspective on the Remitch. How do I know that they think they go? When they die, they take their belongings with them. I'm gonna run it back for you because I know you don't know. When they die, they take their belongings with them. There are some other things that I'm going to address, but I'm going to do it from the top of my head. But let me let you go on and get through. But I wanted to deal with your number one up there. Since you said this is your my I claim qualifier, you're wrong at number one.
Them to respect the offerings given to the other gods in their polytheistic religion.
You're wrong at number four. You're really wrong at a couple of, well, you're wrong at several things here, but I'm not gonna like pound on you because of the lack of knowledge. But I'm talking about your claim qualifier. Since this is what you're using to qualify your argument, you're wrong at number one. You're wrong at number four. You said their rituals, leaving heart and body after death, funerary text. Why would they leave? You got to explain, why would they leave the heart and the body? Why would, because the heart is significant to the remich. That's why it's left. They extracted other things, but the heart was there. Respect the offerings given to gods. What if they didn't appease the gods? Then the offer would be rejected. How do you explain that? Your qualifiers are shaky as hell because you don't have enough information processed to actually qualify shit that you're saying. You said worship, acknowledging the 42 negative confessions during life for after death. See, number five is a problem for you as well. Because earlier, if you read what you said earlier in your claim, since this is your claim qualifiers, they basically told you that it was a morality thing. But among the remich, right? They wanted to live better in their afterlife than they did on earth. Did you know that? They wanted to live better in their afterlife than they did on earth. So they prepared themselves to live as such. The veneration would come from elsewhere. The veneration wouldn't come from the individual that's dying. We're talking about Ma'at. You said the 42 negative confessions were a religion. These things can't equate to anything. This is about morality. They're not even called negative confessions. They're declarations of innocence. That's why you have the I have not and I haves. You say what you have done and you say what you have not done. But this is you. This is not people. This is you judging yourself, looking yourself in the mirror. Have I done what I set out to do today? Well, I have did this, 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 this. I didn't do this, 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 and this. This is you checking yourself. But more importantly, because this is a funerary text or an underworld text, as some people perceive it to be, during that whole in the Ra'anu Perit Imheru, the book of coming forth by day and by night, otherwise known as the book of the dead. There's 37 plates in the book of the dead. You want to focus on one particular plate, which has no overall gist of everything, but it only speaks of the judgment scene. But what about all the other scenes? And this is you judging yourself. This is you attesting to how pure you've been. You slid in venerate nature. Nowhere in the Ra'anu Perit Imheru or in the section of the 42 laws of Ma'at or her as even a deity does it say anything about venerate nature.
And there truly, there really wasn't any obedience to Ma'at at all, because she has a small temple that doesn't come until later on in the dynastic periods. So if she was revered like a cult figure, like a Jesus figure, she would have had followers. She would have had her own cult, but Ma'at didn't have a cult. So your claim qualifiers stand on shaky premises. I'm not even proving your point. You don't even know your point. You're trying to edify something and you don't even know what's going on. You don't. I knew you would come out. Let me finish. Now that you're here, let's have some fun.
Rituals that definitely concern her will be leaving the heart and the body after death and reciting these funerary texts, because, you know, this is the belief that, you know, they need that heart for her to weigh against her father. And they worship her by acknowledging the 42 negative confessions during life for after death. So that's the obedience to
you only get
her.
Look.
Now this was my.
You only get one response from me. When I do my response to this, I'm not responding again, because I ain't giving you that much credit. You have to properly edify yourself. I gave you a list of books and sources to help you educate yourself. You don't do that and you just respond just because you're in your feelings. Are you in trouble? You're going to embarrass yourself. I don't care who watches it.
My qualifier. This was me putting this together based on those definitions. But I have another definition. This is the anthropological definition of religion. A system of symbols which act to establish powerful, pervasive, and long-lasting moods and motivations in men by formulating concepts of a general order of existence and clothing these concepts with such an aura of factuality that the moods and motivations seem uniquely realistic. And so the purpose of these sacred symbols, you know, the ones that establish that mood, is to interpret reality and shape behavior, support received beliefs by invoking deeply felt moral and aesthetic sentiments as experiential evidence for their truth, depict preferences as imposed by reality, synthesize a people's ethos, okay, the tone and the character and quality of life, its moral and aesthetic style and mood. So examples of some sacred symbols that we all know was cross, holy books, statues, words like the gods, like that. You can find these in a book, Religion as a Cultural System, by anthropologist Clifford Geertz. So does this qualify as a religion based on anthropology? So for one, a system of symbols, right? So in Egypt, we have cosmology, we have gods and goddesses, we have temples and statues. So those are definitely symbols, right? And especially because you have the king who definitely offers the statue beginning of his reign, the pharaohs, you know, to maintain order and balance. So we definitely have those things there. We have temples that remind people
Number two and three, literally part of the definition of Ma'at is justice and order. That has everything to do with law. That ain't got shit to do with a religion. That's law. Justice and order. See, when you're dealing with these concepts, you have to be more specific in what you're saying. And you really need to read the true works of real anthropologists, social and cultural anthropologists, because they tell you in their works that they struggle with the definitions that are provided, because there's no one definition that is set to actually explain cultural things. That's why cultural context is key in all of these discussions, which you just eliminated the Egyptians. You use nothing from the Egyptians. But let you finish, man, because you got like a, you about to quit.
Of the gods and to keep Maat, which is order. So we got, does it establish powerful, pervasive, long-lasting moods and motivations in men by formulating concepts of a general order or existence? So, like, literally part of the definition of Maat is justice and order. So yes, they definitely did that. So 4 and 5, popping these conceptions with such an aura of factuality that the moods and motivations seem uniquely realistic. So with rituals and priests and pharaohs being a meditation between God and the people.
By the fucking way. A ritual would be, let me tell you how delicate ritual is. Every morning when you wake up, you do a few things to get yourself together. You use the restroom, wash your hands and face, brush your teeth. No matter what order you do them in, you do them every day. That's a ritual. That's how delicate ritual is. After you do that, you may make your bed up. Some people don't make their bed up. So their next move, they might get ready to go to work. If they showered the night before, and that's how they do their thing, or they might just hop in the shower. Some people might just hop straight in the shower, get out of the shower, then brush that, use the bathroom while they're in the shower, if they got a number one. And then when they get out the shower, brush their teeth, go get dressed or whatever. You might walk by a picture in your household, somebody that's dead. You might have, you know, you might miss them or whatever, that was real close to you. And you might look at the picture. You might wave at the picture. You might kiss it. You might blow a kiss at it. Or you might in some way acknowledge it on your way out the door. That could be perceived as such. You're saying these things, but you're not defining them properly, or you're not using any evidence to argue your point. So this is why you don't really conclude here. There's no conclusion. I'm not going to attack your methodology, but it needs work, and I'm gonna show you.
They definitely made this very uniquely realistic. You know, once that happens and everybody in society is moving in order and everything like that, that definitely personifies Maat. So she definitely, that definitely qualifies as a religion based on this anthropological definition.
Okay.
So these are some of the books. I did put some sites, I'm sorry, I put some sources under my, under some slides.
That's cool.
These are some more sources that I used for this.
That's cool. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Now,
thank you, Denise.
I am done. So I showed today that yes, it's religious. Yes, Maat is religious. They definitely used it religiously. And I don't know how you could ever say it's not. That's all.
Adios. Bye-bye. Hakuna Matata. So that's Denise's presentation. I extended it because I stopped it. So I want to go ahead and I want to, let me go back in case I want to come back to the video. Let me pause it. Listen, the etymology of religion Y'all need to read this. Read this. This is one thing that a lot of people need to read. It's a good little arguments in there. I'm not going to show it to you right now because I want to get directly into the cook.
So,
a response to the information age is My Eye a Religion by yours truly. Balance, harmony, truth, justice, reciprocity. Now, what I didn't do in this presentation is I didn't want to drag it out. So I didn't want to get into, you know, how my eye is defined in Rani Kemet. That is the Egyptian spoken language. And I didn't want to get into some, you know, I didn't want to go get some linguistic work to show some support. I didn't want to do all of that because I knew her presentation was short and it was really surface level. And she don't really study African traditions and customs. So she's not familiar with how those things shape up. So her worldview is jaded by her perception of what a religion is, according to whoever created the word religion. And we need to take a look at that. So here's my introduction. In a recent discussion on Science with Sean, the topic of religion came up during a live stream. A sister who represents the information age named Denise uttered the words that Ma'at and astrology were both religions. I attempted to inform the sister that Ma'at is not a religion, and to assert such would mean her interpretation of religion is lacking understanding. She wanted to argue, insinuating that it was and that she do a presentation to demonstrate that it was. I welcome the presentation, and here's my response. Religion. You heard her define it. The belief in the existence of a god or gods and the activities that are connected with the worship of them or in the teachings of a spiritual leader. I just threw this up here for shits and giggles. Kimoyo. It means vitalism, universal matter, the ability to add life to life, vital power, and material life. The source for this is Dr. Fukiao, an African PhD. Hypothesis. I am of the belief that the information age, more specifically Denise, do not study Africa at all, let alone the cultural and traditional practices of ancient Kemet. The moment she argues that Ma'at is a religion, she interjects her worldview on an ancient practice that has long surpassed us and ignored the evidence pertaining to the role Ma'at played in the pantheon of deities among the Remitch. I believe she ignored the evidence and historicity of Ma'at due to a level of information not made available to her. So I don't know why these images ain't showing, but define a religion. So the term religion from Latin religio, meaning bind, connect, the set of common beliefs and practices pertaining to the supernatural and its relationship to humanity and the cosmos, which are often codified into prayer, ritual, scriptures, and religious law. Continuing to define religion. All right. Now, 1200 CE, religion, state of life bound by monastic vows, also action or conduct indicating a belief in a divine power and reverence for and a desire to please it. From the Anglo-French religio, 11th century, old French religion, religion, pity, devotion, religious community, and directly from Latin religionem, nominative religio, respect for what is sacred, reverence for the gods, conscientiousness, sense of rights, moral obligation, fear of gods, divine service, religious observance, religion, a faith, a mode of worship, cult, sanctity, holiness, in late Latin monastic life. Notice the key words here, 1200. 1300 CE, Common Era. This noun of an action was derived from Cicero, from relegere, go through again.
in reading or in thoughts. From re again, see re, ligare read. However, popular etymology among the late ancient service, Lactinius, Augustine, and interpretation of many modern writers connects it with regalere, to bind fast, see relay, via the notion of a place of obligation on or bound between humans and gods. In that case, the re would be intensive. Another possible origin is religion's careful, opposite of negligence. In English, the meaning, particularly system of faith in the worship of a divine being or beings, is by 1300 CE, the sense of recognition of an allegiance and manner of life perceived as justly due to a higher unseen power or powers, is from the 1530s. The word religion has been defined in a wide variety of manners, with most definitions attempting to find a balance somewhere between overly restrictive categorizations and meaningless generalities. In this quest, a variety of approaches have been employed, including the use of formalistic doctrinal definitions and the emphasis experimental, emotive, intuitive, valuational, and ethical factors. Peep game, ladies and gentlemen. Sociologists and anthropologists tend to see religion as an abstract set of ideas, values, or experiences developed as part of a cultural matrix. For example, in George A. Lingbuck's Nature of Doctrine, religion does not refer to a belief in God or a transcendent absolute. Instead, Lingbuck defines religion as a kind of cultural and or linguistic framework or mediums that shapes the entirety of life and thought. It is similar to the idiom that makes possible the description of realities, the formulations of beliefs, and the experiences of inner attitudes, feelings, and sentiments. According to this definition, religion refers to one's primary worldview and how this dictates one's thoughts and actions. Other religious scholars have put forward a definition of religion that avoids reductionism of the various sociological and psychological disciplines that reduce religion to its component factors. Religion may be defined as a presence of a belief in the sacred or the holy. For example, Rudolf Otto's The Idea of Holy, formulated in 1917. Defines the essence of religion awareness as awe, a unique blend of fear of fascination before the divine. Schleiermacher in the late 18th century defined religion as a feeling of an absolute dependence. All of this being said, some scholars call the utility of the term religion into question, as it creates or reifies a distinction between the circular and sacred elements of human existence. They bear little relation to the lived experience of believers. As Jonathan Z. Smith argues, religion as a discrete category is solely the creation of the scholar's study. It is created for the scholar's analytic purpose by his imaginative acts of comparison and generalization. You're hearing that word very often. Attempts to define religion have proved to be controversial and contested. There are many competing definitions by scholars and judges, but no consensus has emerged. There are at least 17 definitions of religion, and scholars may never agree on any essentialist definition. Attempts to define religion may prove to be controversial and contested. There are many competing definitions. I don't know why I got that again, but I had to slow that down for y'all. But no consensus has emerged. Remember that. No consensus has emerged. You heard us say it. I'm going to tell you three times. The problem of defining religion is not without real consequences. not least for questions of whether specific groups can obtain legal recognition as religions. About to get interesting. Ideally, a guide to the nature and the history of philosophy of religion would begin with the analysis of definition of religion. Unfortunately, there is no current consensus on a precise identification of the necessary and sufficient conditions of what counts as a religion. I'm going to say that again. There is no current consensus on a precise identification of the necessary and sufficient conditions of what counts as a religion. We therefore currently lack a decisive criterion that would enable clear rulings whether some movements should count as religions, i.e. Scientology, cargo cults, and Pacific Islands. Among non-legal scholars in philosophy and religion, there is a very lively debate as to whether the word religion can or should be defined. It has been observed that the effort to define religion is as old as the academic study of religion itself. In fact, dozens, if not hundreds, of proposals have been made, each claiming to solve the definitional problem in a new and unique way. Needless to say, no one definition of religion has garnered a consensus, and the definitional enterprise, as well as the debate over the very need for definitions, continue in full rigor. Attempts to define religion have been controversial and contested. Many competing definitions have been proposed by scholars and judges, but no consensus emerged. As religion is a fundamental term in Section 116 of the Australian Constitution, it is important to continue seeking an accepted definition of religion for the purpose of constitutional interpretation. Let us begin by recognizing that definitions are not real things. This is an anthropologist. Right here, current information from Eller. He wrote this nice book that I would love to share with everybody on this whole religion thing. Very nice book. He says, let us begin by recognizing that definitions are not real things. They are human and therefore cultural creations and categories, not natural facts. See, when you jump out the window, when you start trying to label certain stuff religious and blah, 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 you have to recognize that an anthropologist is telling you that they're not real things. They are human and therefore cultural creations and categories, not natural facts. You're arguing it like it's a fact. It's not a natural fact. A definition is not true. It is only more or less inclusive and productive. A narrow definition excludes phenomena that would be included within a wider definition. For instance, if we were to define religion as a belief in one God, we would be disqualifying as religion all of the belief systems that lack a single God. So very few belief systems would qualify. If we define it as a belief in gods, we would still be disqualifying the religions that contain no gods. By imposing one conception of religion on others, we would be defining them into non-religion, i.e., if you don't believe in a God, then you don't have a religion. The act of defining is an attempt to specify what is unique and distinct about the subject. The sine qua non or without that not, what makes it what it is. Probably no single definition of something as diverse as religion could ever quite capture it. Rather, what we find is that various definitions emphasize certain aspects or betray the theoretical orientations of their authors. For instance, one of the earliest anthropologists, E.B. Taylor, posited in his 1871 Primitive Culture a minimum of simplest possible definitions of religion. The belief in the spiritual being a more compact assessment can hardly be imagined, but it faces at least one complication. It introduced other terms, belief in spiritual beings, that beg for definitions. My bad. All right, y'all should be able to see it now. Now, it would be foolish to attempt to adjudicate between the definitions of religion. It would be foolish to attempt to adjudicate between the definitions of religion. Fool? One major problem in anthropology of religion is the definition of religion itself. Run it back. One major problem in anthropology of religion is the definition of religion itself. Let's go. Let's go ahead and deal with my art. You see her name right there, Ma'at. The daughter of who? Who's she the daughter of? This don't come to the later dynastic periods, but who's she the daughter of? Who is Ma'at the daughter of? Who know? Hmm? Who's she the daughter of? Defining my art. If you are a leader who governs the affairs of the many, seek every excellent deed so that your conduct may be blameless. For my art is great, it endures and it is effective. It has not been disturbed since the time it was created. It is a path even for the unlearned, and one who violates its laws is punished. But for the greedy fails to grasp this. Although baseness may seize wealth, wrongdoing has never brought its goods to a safe port. In the end, it is Ma'at which lasts, and one says of it, it is the ground of my father. The central concept of Egyptian cosmology and ethics was personified as the goddess Ma'at wearing an ostrich feather on her head. The word Ma'at can mean truth, justice, righteousness, order, balance, and cosmic law. The goddess Ma'at was the beloved daughter of Ra, the creator sun god. She traveled with him in the sun bark, delighting his heart and giving life to his nostrils. The primary duty of the Egyptian king was to be the champion of Ma'at. In the afterlife, the dead were judged on whether they had done and spoken Ma'at. From the old kingdom onward, Ma'at's presence was thought to be vital to the daily regeneration of the sun god. In the underworld books, she is often shown standing close to Ra in both the day and the night boats of the sun. This or the dual nature of Egypt has two kingdoms may explain why Ma'at can appear as two identical goddesses. Ma'at, the basis of social order, is a value that can neither be bought nor bargained away. The social order secretes benevolence and loving kindness without stifling personal initiatives and work. Ir seka ek, if you cultivate a farm. Ma'at castigates slander, lying, defamation, boastfulness, and flattery. All persons, great or humble, rich or poor, deserve respect. Such are unequivocal prescriptions of Ma'at. Order is a categorical imperative. Nader Ma'at im sinis. Stick to the truth. Do not exaggerate. In the last analysis, what prevails is justice, Ma'at. Think about the two things that I just said here. Think about them. Stick to truth. Do not exaggerate. You ain't sticking the truth. The concept of Ma'at is complex, multi-layered. To understand it, we need to examine it on three levels. One, On the universal level, the concept of Ma'at expresses the harmony of the elements is clearly established, each in its right place. This is the concept of the order, whole, the cosmos. Two, on a political level, the concept of Ma'at works against injustice. It is in the name of Ma'at that the Pharaoh subjugates rebels and dominates foreign lands. Three, on the individual level, Ma'at embraces specific rules for the living in concert with moral principles. Whoever lives according to these rules and principles achieves universal order in his or her own life, in practical terms, and living in harmony with the order whole. The most accomplished, useful, and appropriate human actions are circumscribed in the cosmological order, as symbolized by the way the Pharaoh's name is written inside of a circular cartouche or a shenu, a perfect geometrical shape representing the vitalizing sun. Now, when I mentioned Kimoyo to you earlier, one of the words that was used in Kimoyo was vitalism. That word is significant, and it also meant adding life to life and a lot of other things. In the cosmic order of things, why would it geometrical shape represent something that's vitalizing, something that is symbolic? Something to think about. Ma'at personified both divine and worldly order, as well as the concept of justice. All legal cases, even those concerning the Pharaoh, were bound by her. As the highest judge and legislator of the country, the ruler in particular was obliged to honor the enacting of laws and the administration of justice in accordance with Ma'at. Ma'at therefore represented supreme ethics and an awareness of right and wrong doing. Why is this taken away? Even the officials appointed by the Pharaoh were legally bound by Ma'at, who thus represented the ethical basis of the structure of the state. The high-ranking visors, as well as the low-ranking scribe, was considered to be a keeper of Ma'at. In the Book of the Dead, the Hall of the Two Truths, or the Double Ma'at, is the place where the souls of the dead come to be judged. The hearts of the dead were weighed against the feather of Ma'at, and in her image sometimes surmounts the scales. If, like Ra, the dead person had Ma'at in his or her heart, the scales would balance and the deceased would be declared true of voice, or what we know as Ma'at Karu, which is true of voice or justified. Ancient Egyptians always believed in a natural law that embraced social justice and morality. I'm gonna run that back. Ancient Egyptians always believed in a natural law that embraced social justice and morality. In the course of time, this was supplemented by decrees and laws of the kings, which were kept in writing and archived. The following statement by Horneb in 1323 BC has been recorded. I gave rules to their face, the officials, and added laws to their collections. Therefore, laws in the New Kingdom were cited as Pharaoh's law, or began with the introduction, Pharaoh says. In any case, the legal idea of Ma'at had to be taken into account when it came to passing judgment. Even the officials appointed by the Pharaoh were legally bound by Ma'at, who's thus represented the ethical basis of the structure of the state. The high-ranking visor, as well as the low-ranking scribe. Come on, man, I gotta run it back. So let's take a little bit of history, not in any type of order, but a little bit of history of Ma'at. Ma'at was first recognized and mentioned in the Old Kingdom pyramid text 1582. A temple in Karnak was built during the New Kingdom in 1569 in her honor. The Ra Nuparit Emheru was written in the Middle Kingdom 1550 BC. Prior, no judgment scene existed. Courts of justice wasn't until the Fifth Dynasty. Courts of justice appeared So 2494 BCE, you start seeing these courts of justices. Now, I know what y'all thinking. Why would I even talk about underworld texts? She only brought up one. She brought up the Book of the Dead. But what I want to know is, can you explain all the other underworld texts that she shows up in some instance or in some form, but you're only stuck on the Papyrus of Ani and not the other papyruses who have another person's name on it? But it's okay, we'll just deal with that. But you don't mention the pyramid text, you don't mention the coffin text, you don't mention you only the Amduat, you don't mention the Book of Caverns, the Book of Earth, the Book of the Sky, the Book of Day, the Book of Nut. You don't mention any of that. You focused on the Book of the Dead, or what we know as the Book of Coming Forth by Day and by Night, the Rod Nuparit M. Heru. So let's talk about the Book of the Dead. The famous Book of the Dead, as we know it, is compiled of a 37-plate text that speaks toward the specifics of becoming an ancestor from the time one transitions and enters the realm of the ancestors. The Book of the Dead has been misrepresented by many, insinuating that this book was the equivalent to the Bible, but in no way was this text considered anything as such. The Book of the Dead's primary focus was the afterlife, nothing more or less. The book speaks specifically about death and moral judgment. To claim one seen as a religion is significantly in a misrepresentation of a broader text. Africa has yet to have agency over its cultural and traditional practices since the coming of Islam and Christianity. Even though the experts haven't decided on a true definition of the word religion, many have tried to frame African Kimoyo in such a way that it can't detach itself from the rest of the world. Culturally, the Remich were different and maintained its African presence for quite some time. Although foreign invaders and students of ancient Kemet have developed a field of study out of Egypt, the religious justifications in a lot of their works are very present. The underworld or afterlife texts have continued to be misrepresented, and until a clear lens is placed on the eyes of the beholder, this mistake will continue to happen. Our dear sister Denise has to take into account the many numerous scenes in the Book of the Dead and the additional underworld texts that precede the Book of the Dead. Egyptians morally proceed to hold themselves accountable in life and the next. And that meant enough to them to develop a mythological story to explain what they did not have answers for, which is a very African thing to do. I would highly recommend studying actual texts of those times and learning the language of the Remich. This will allow her to gain a better perspective on life in ancient Kemet, but most importantly, how placing African traditions in a box is detrimental in the learning process. In her presentation, Denise argued that Africans agreed with the definition of religion. Basically, she didn't say it, but the way she presented it would mean that Africans agreed with the definition of religion and defined themselves in such a light. When we look at Africans and study the traditions, Kimoyo is the best way to explain the cultural behaviors of each tradition from east to south and north to central Africa. Egyptologists for some time, especially people like E.A. Wallace Budge and Gerald Massey, have looked to justify Christianity in their works. Both have Christian roots like many other Egyptologists and look for similarities to justify Christianity's role and impact on the world. I got some more to add, but here go my sources. They in the description of the video, but here go my sources. They were on each slide, but here go my sources. Here go my sources. Now, let me talk about the 42 laws of Ma'at, or the declarations of innocence as we know it. Let me talk about the 42 laws of Ma'at. What are those laws? How could you make a religion out of 42 laws of Ma'at? Huh? How could you make a religion out of it? I have not committed sin. I have not committed robbery with violence. I have not stolen. I have not slain men or women. I have not stolen food. I have not swindled offerings. I have not stolen from the god or goddesses. I have not told lies. I have not slept the shit out of Denise today. I have not done this. I have not done that. I've did this. I've did that. I've did this. I've did that. See? What you realize is, you didn't have people running around in Kemet, right? You didn't have these people running around and reciting these things in a manner to which the people over here in America want you to believe was the thing. It was not the thing. That judgment scene, that plate that talks about the declarations of innocence, that's a scene in a book for an underworld text, and not even book in the sense of a Bible or the equivalent to. And this is the mistake many people have made. See, there's this real smart scholar, right? It's a real smart scholar. His name is Ogilvy. In the Papyrus of Ani, right, he writes a preface. Yeah, he writes a preface. And in the preface, this is what he says right here. Watch this. It's going to sound similar to something that I alluded to. The nature of the book. If you got this on page 13, the book looked like this. Let me share my screen. So you know what I'm saying? A lot of y'all might, it's the big book, right? It's the book with all the extra work in it. Even the shit that she ain't never read, right? It's got the images of all the scenes. You know, I got pages that fold out. And so on some of these pages that fold out, but every single plate is right there. See how this fold out? They go, look, let me stop you real quick. Let me put this on the screen real quick. Read that, Denise. Damn. My bad. Read that, Denise. What that say? You kept saying something else. What that say? The declarations of innocence. What it say? Before the gods of the tribunal. Right? You call them negative confessions. They call them declarations of innocence. Remember, this is an underworld text. So in their mythological story, this is you trying to become a wazir. You wouldn't be considered rich enough to be able to purchase a Radnu Peretz Amheru. Everybody that died in Egypt, bro, didn't have no Book of the Dead when they died. These little texts like this, they wasn't with everybody. So when you generalize and say that the 42 laws or the declarations of innocence was a religion, how the fuck could it be a religion when everybody didn't even have the fucking Book of the Dead with them? A lot of people died without the damn declarations of innocence. So how could it be a religion if the majority of the population died without the Book of the Dead in their possession? That ends the conversation. Just to be on a one on some one thou wow, it ends the conversation. All that stuff you was kicking, it ends that. All of that. Oh, it was a religion. You didn't even define it. You tried to say it was a religion, and it ain't even a consensus on religion, and nobody know what the hell a religion is. How you gonna give credence to a word that came up in the 1300s and say, oh, this, all these other things was a religion too, because these people made up the word in 1300s. Now it associates with everything. This is why they have trouble grasping to a consensus, because people's cultures are different. They don't see things the same way. Your definition doesn't work for Africans. Your definition works for Abrahamics, who gladly accept the word religion and the way that it is defined. It don't work for Africans. You don't know where it works, but you impose this thought on Africans. And I'm speaking for the entire continent at this juncture, and not just the primary focus on ancient Kemet. So you're gonna tell me something that comes thousands of years later is going to define the cultural and traditional practices of Africans who knew nothing of a religion. These people did what they did every day. But you said the declarations of innocence were a religion. So if it was a religion, why, when the people who died never had a copy of it, they wouldn't even know what it was in it? Hold, let me make it make sense. Let me make it make sense all the way. Denise and Google Scholar, because you be pseudo like all the time. Denise and Google Scholar, let me just be clear to y'all. When people died, the people who didn't have a Ranu Paritz Amheru, they don't know nothing about all this other stuff until it was written on the walls of a temple. When they wrote the declarations of innocence on the wall of a temple, it became visible to those who could go up and see it. Now you're insinuating that the population, everybody, could see it. There's 42 gnomes. These declarations wasn't in every gnome. These declarations, you really don't see them on the wall until the 18th dynastic period at the Temple of Karnak, where Ramesses is posted up at. You don't see them in the south. You don't see them all over the place like that. Most of these deities in the Egyptian pantheon don't even travel in certain places. That's how much y'all know about ancient Kemet. Nothing. You don't. So to insinuate that all these people knew something would be very disingenuous, because if I'm nowhere near Karnak and I've never been to a temple and I die, I ain't got no Book of the Dead. I ain't got no Book of the Dead. It's well without my reach. I don't know nothing about most of this stuff. What y'all are so caught up in is something y'all ain't even really did the focused on. You didn't have no research question. You're speaking from emotions. You're trying to define everything by someone else's definition of something. You never took the time out to find out what Africans had to say about African shit. You never looked to see if any of those words are even the equivalent. And if you look, if you were real anthropologists say, they will tell you the word religion in other people's culture has no existence. The word may not even exist to these people. So you just gonna give them a word that don't even exist to them. What the hell they do that at? What they do that at? Who gives people a word that didn't even exist to them? African Americans, people who call themselves Google Scholar, just make up shit because it sounds like something. Oh, it sounds like it. Sound like it. Sound like it. You know what I'm saying? It sounds like it. So what I have on the screen is the article that I told y'all about earlier, The Etymology of Religion by Sarah F. Hotz, Johns Hopkins University, Baltimore, Maryland. She uses the Oxford Dictionary and says, the connection of the word religion or regalia to bind has usually been favored by modern writers. This etymology given by Roman grammarian end of the 14th century, Servius, was supported by the Christian philosopher Lactantius, 313 AD, who quotes the expression of celebrated Roman philosophical poet Lucretius, religium enim notus exsolvere, in proof that he considers ligaria, to bind, to be the root of regalio. Several commentators upon Lucretius, Morell, Monroe, Harper's Dictionary, Classical Literature and Antiquities, and also Joseph Mayer in his commentary on Cicero's De Natura Deorum agree that this notion of binding was in the mind of Lucretius. St. Augustine, the most celebrated father of the Latin Church, AD 354-430, makes this derivation. The Century Dictionary, though, referring to the uncertain origin of religio, cites the English ligament as perhaps allied. So Harper's Latin lexicon refers to coracines, ossipar, as taking religio in the same sense of obligatio. Other Latin nouns like lictor or lex have the root leg. Now, especially the rare English words relegate, relegation, suggest religion as having the root regalare, to bind, for Christopher Cartwright wrote, he at the top. Let me try to zoom in, move this right there where you can see it. They are not relegated or united within the same communion. I'm going to say this again. They are not relegated or united within the same communion. And St. Coleridge says, it is not even religion. It does not relegate, does not bind anew. So W.E. Gladstone said, religion with the debased worship appended to it, but with no relegating, no binding power. But in De Natura Deorum, Cicero derives religio from relegere as meaning to go through or over again in reading, speech, or thought. Cicero says a whole bunch of stuff I'm not going to repeat because I don't know what that is. But in the Notes Atticae of the Roman grammarian, Lullus Gellius is preserved an old verse which supports this derivation. Relegetim esse apporte religio son nefas, identical with relegere in the Greek, to heed, to have a care for, and in support of this derivation of the word religion. Cortius quotes Iliad. Professor Skeet of the University of Cambridge says, his etymological dictionary, page 500, religion seems to be connection with the English rec, to heed, to have a care for. From tectonic base rec, Aryan rag, the derivation may be traced through Middle High German, Middle English, or Chaucer's time in Anglo-Saxon. In Mark 12, 14, we find bunerest, thou carest not. Our term religion is used also in the sense of scrupulosity, conscientious scruple. Ben Johnson says, out of religion to my charge, I have made a self-decree near to express my person. In an authorized version, religion is used of outward forms rather than inner spirits. In the Century Dictionary, the two passages, James 1:26 and Acts 13:43, are quoted. Religion was so used by Jeremy Taylor as meaning the rites and ceremonies of religion, what she was pleased to believe apt to minister to her devotions and the religions of her pious and discerning soul. Latimer, in his sermon, writes, "For religion standeth the righteousness, justice, and well-doing." In Shakespeare's As You Like It, Act 4, Scene 1, Orlando says that he will religiously keep a promise. Religious means originally observant, conscientious, strict. A religious Jew is a Jew who observes the rulers of the Sabbath, the dietary laws, who does not neglect them. Religere is opposed to religere, which stands for neglect, not observe, not heed, not attend to, be remiss in attention to duty toward a thing. An irreligious Jew neglects the law. Religion is akin to diligence and opposed to negligence. The Greek is generally used with a negative equivalent to Latin. Strict observance of law and conscience, heed of duty, involves taking pains, painstaking scrumptuousity. This explains the connection of religion with pain, painful. But as Waldo says in his well-known Latin dictionary, an idea of choice and interest may be connected with religion. Latin delego, that is, des as lego, may be associated with reckoning, electing. There may be a picking out, as in German phrase, Soldaten Aschang, recruiting soldiers, so Waldo. If all points are carefully considered, Cicero's view would seem to be preferable to so that religion is not derived from religere, but from religere. It is true that a clause from Cicero's Oratio de Domo 105 is cited. Nesi etim numeribus religios, or whatever he says, in proof that Cicero himself could not help connecting the word religio with the idea of obligation. So in the second Philippic occurs religio abstinere, and a de domo 106, 124, we find domum religion obligere. But inconsistency occurs in the writing of all great men, and the present, of course, always expected. The commentator most sure of himself is usually the most mistaken. An experience which has been brought home to me very forcibly in the Old Testament Seminary of the Johns Hopkins University. I present the modest contribution to a most intricate problem before the galaxy of distinguished comparative philologians in the hope of getting some illuminative suggestions on a subject in which I have always taken a profound interest. Religion is all over the place. That's why you don't have no consensus. So to say that something is religious, man, is pseudoscientific, because you don't have a definition that scholars agree upon, or you can't even agree upon a working definition. And therefore, you can't say that a people who was not buried with the Book of the Dead knew anything about the religion, because there's a possibility of always that all people 4,000 square miles may not have ever dealt with Maat on a sense of what you think they may have dealt with Maat on. You asserted, you imposed, you didn't let your information answer the research question. Is Maat a religion? You said it in the chat. The research question was, is Maat a religion? Then you switched it up and said the 42 declarations of innocence was a religion, and you could not demonstrate that the 42 declarations of innocence was a religion. Show me where you did it. You didn't present evidence. You stated your position, and your position was ass backwards. Ass backwards. Yeah. y'all don't agree with me on this show, they sensitive, we will do another one where y'all can speak. Who is y'all? Who is y'all? Just because we don't agree, you want to go somewhere where y'all agree? That's how real is that? How real is that? You mad because everybody in the chat don't agree with what you did because you didn't answer the research questions. You didn't find supportive evidence to suggest that Ma'at was a fucking religion. You didn't show evidence to say that Ma'at, the Declarations of Innocence, was a religion. You just tried to extract two things and say these things, this is a whole religion. Show me the people that were practicing this religion in ancient Egypt. You didn't show none. You refer to a book that is an ancestral manual for dead people. So you had to die to get the damn book. And most of the people that died couldn't even afford to get one written for them. So the people who died and didn't have the Book of the Dead for themselves, they don't have the instructions to become a wazir. Only a selected people would have the damn instructions, because that's what the damn book is. The Book of the Dead ain't nothing but an ancestral manual telling the I don't even know how a dead person reading this shit, but how a dead person can come a fucking god. Or was seer, an ancestor, be deified. They dead. They have no way of knowing if all of this shit is true. Come on, man. Put this into reality. They had no way of knowing if it was true. The people who could afford it, it just looked nice in their goddamn caskets. They had their instructions. They were on their way. But they had a strong belief in the afterlife. True. Because they wanted to live in the afterlife better than they lived on earth. This is why when they died, they took their belongings with them. This is why you look in a freaking casket, you see these little toy-like looking men and all these other things that they were buried with, you begin to realize what it was that was going on. This is why you also had servants. When a king died, there would be servants to join him in the afterlife. That was their belief. They thought they was dying with their king. Their king dead, they going right with him. This was many cultures' belief. This wasn't just the Remetch. This was many ancient cultures. Wasn't just no damn the Egyptians. We see this shit in West Africa too, Central Africa too, South Africa too, East Africa too. So if you don't have a If you don't have the time to study a subject matter, why would you even open your mouth and utter a word? You just capping. You running around here just running off at the lips. I'm telling you, I ain't listening to no more video. I ain't responding no more because I already know what level you are on. You can't even go deep on the subject matter to actually deal with the subject matter. You like, really, you fumbled the ball. Like, for real, demonstrating would be, all right, I'm going to find you these evidence of these people actually worshiping, or these people, yeah, these people actually worshiping the Declarations of Innocence because you called it a religion. So based on the definition of religion that you actually used, you got to go back and argue that. You got to go back and argue your definition of religion and show where these people were religiously going up to this Declarations of Innocence, since all of them didn't have access to it. You got to go show me people going to the wall the tomb at Karnak and people coming in and out of there like Sunday service. This shit ain't gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. So I don't want to hear all of that. It's a religion, nigga. You speaking from feelings and not from facts. Just keep it a buck all the way. So here go the book that I referred to right here. Introducing Anthropology of Religion, Culture to the Ultimate. This is the third edition. Go get the scholarship. This wasn't the only book. I used this. That's one book, two books, three books, four, five, six, seven, eight. Where else are you? I think I used eight. Yeah, I used eight. I used eight books. Could have used 10, 12, but I didn't. Could have used Kofi book. I left Kofi shit out of it. I wanted to, but then I figured it would be a waste of time. Which it really, kind of sort of was that. But hopefully, you know what I'm saying? Some people get something out of it. Some people would get some use out of it. So when people bring up religion, I'm gonna keep it a buck. When people use the word religions, you know what they refer to? Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Buddhism. You say that the Remitch were polytheistic or polytheism, you didn't show it. There's no evidence of such. You just argue from ignorance. You just threw out some stuff. When we are studying religion, what exactly are we doing? What exactly is religion? This raises the issue of definition. Let us begin by recognizing that definitions are not real things. They are human and therefore cultural creations and categories, not natural facts. A definition is not true. It is only more and less inclusive or productive. A narrow definition excludes phenomena that would be included within a wider definition. For instance, if we were to define religion as a belief in one God, we would be disqualified as religions. You heard me say it in the slides. It's all in the slides. But let me continue. This attitude echoes the fictional Parsons Thwackum in Henry Fielding's novel, The History of Tom Jones, who declared, "When I mention religion, I mean the Christian religion, and not only the Christian religion, but the Protestant religion, and not only the Protestant religion, but the Church of England. That is not an attitude that an anthropologist or anyone else should take. The act of defining is an attempt to specify what is unique and distinct about the subject, the sin quo non, or without that, not." You heard me say it. For instance, one of the earlier anthropologists, E.B. Taylor, posited in 1871. You heard me say it, but let's go a little bit further and see what E.B. Taylor said. I mean, what others said. James Frazer, what he say? "A propitation or consolation of power superior to man, which believed to direct and control the course of nature and human life." That's one definition. Let's get another one. Sociologists. "A unified system of beliefs and practices related to sacred things. That is to say, things set aside and forbidden, beliefs and practices which unite into one single moral community called a church. All those who adhere to them." Next, it consists of two parts. The first is an easy definable, if not precisely specific feeling. And the second, certain acts, customs, beliefs, and conceptions associated with this feeling. The belief most intricately connected with the specific feeling is a belief in spirits outside of man, conceived as more powerful than man and as controlling all those elements in life upon which he laid most stress. Anthony Wallace, "A set of rituals rationalized by myth." which mobilizes supernatural powers for the purpose of achieving or preventing transformations of state and man and nature. Sherry Otnor, a metasystem that solves problems of meanings or problems of meaning, generated in large part, though not entirely, by the social order by grounding that order within a theoretical ultimate reality within which those problems will make sense. And perhaps Clifford Geertz provided the most frequently quoted definition: a system of symbols which act to establish powerful, pervasive, and long-lasting modes of motivation in men by formulating conceptions of a general order of existence and clothing these conceptions with such an aurora faculty that the moods and motivations seem uniquely realistic. Meanwhile, can y'all see that? Y'all should be able to see that real good. Rudolf Otte thought it was the mysterious experience of the holy Karl Marx, thought it was false consciousness intended to justify and perfect exploitation of laborers, opiate of the masses. Sigmund Freud thought it was a projection of unconscious psychological process. Levi Breuer thought, at least for the time, that it was a product of primitive mentality, and so on. Clearly, there is no scholarly consensus about this thing called religion that emphasize different aspects of it, whether belief in ideas or ritual or feeling or morality or community. Further, they introduce other terms in the definition that plunge us into a definitional spiral. What is a spirit, divine, belief, sacred, or holy? Finally, does it refer to something real out there or merely something inside us? The truth is that religion probably involves all these variables simultaneously, but desperately, despairingly, for different religions. Ritual, for instance, is certainly a key element of religion, although not all religions promote or elaborate it equally. Ideas and concepts are universal aspects of religion, although not all religions have the same concepts or necessarily very conscious and consistent ones. Language or verbal action, including myth, is important, as is morality or notions of good and bad behavior, and of course, community. But then rituals, ideas, verbal actions, morals, and communities exist apart from religion too. They are not essentially religion's phenomena. What makes religion religious? It would fool to attempt to adjudicate between the definitions of religion. Each highlights a piece of the puzzle. Instead, we want to mark out an approach to religion that distinguishes it from other human endeavors and thought systems and yet connects it to them. What unifies religion with a social action, an institution, a physical, embodied, ritualistic, and verbal behavior? A concern with good or correct action, the desire to achieve certain goals or effects, the establishment of perpetuations of communities. What distinguishes religion is the object of focus of these actions, namely non-human and typically superhuman beings and or forces which humans are understood to be in relation or recognizably social relations that is mutually effective. Robin Horton expresses, in every situation commonly labeled religious, we are dealing with actions directed toward objects which are believed to respond in terms of certain categories in our own culture. Those are of purpose, intelligence, and emotion, which are also the distinctive categories for the description of human action. The application of these categories leads us to say that such objects are personified. The relationship between human beings and religious objects can be further defined as governed by certain ideas of patterning and obligations, such as characterized relations among human beings. In short, religion can be looked upon as an extension of the field of people's social relationship between the confines of purely human society. And for completeness' sake, we should perhaps add the rider that the extension must be on which human beings involved see themselves in a dependent position, vice versa, their non-human alter. That is to say, religion is an expoliation of culture. To include in society as a cultural non-human beings and or forces. The key for anthropology is that religious beings and or forces are almost universally social with the qualities of a person or at least agents of some sort. If they were not, how would we make sense of them and what we do with about them? In other words, humans see themselves in a religious context as occupying a certain kind of relationship with some beings and or forces, which we can rightly call social relationship. It is a relationship of communication, intention, reciprocity, respect, avoidance, control, etc. The beings and or forces are like us in some ways, despite the fact that they are greatly unlike us in others. They may have a language, usually ours, personality or intentionality, desires, interests, dislikes, likes. They may live in their own social arrangements, and they can be summoned or influenced. This takes us to the real significance of religion as a cultural factor and its real distinction from other domains of culture. Economics, kinship, politics, these are all about humans. The characteristics in religion are different, but they are not so different. They are non-human. The dead, ancestors, spirits, plants, animals, natural objects, the sun and moon, or natural forces, the wind and rain are gods, impersonal supernatural forces like mani or chi, yet they interact with us. They're part of society. For instance, in a classic encounter, Irvin Howe reporting asking Ojibwe Elder and all the stones are alive and animate, and the man replied, no, but some are. Peep this. In fact, the human propensities that make culture and society possible make religion possible. Michael Jackson claimed that religion flows from our drive toward relatedness, toward forming bonds and attachments, and this human capacity for forming bonds knows no bonds, encompassing other persons, objects, animals, abstract ideas, ideology, possession, either earth or cosmos. Maurice Bloch a year earlier went further, asserting that what we call religion is simply one manifestation of human transcendental sociality, that is, our ability to and tendency to relate to others, human and non-human alike, in ways that go beyond their apparent or surface qualities. He gave an example of the Madagascar elder who was infirm and somewhat senile, but still treated with respect and afforded an important role because of the person that he once was. Since transcendental social relationships rely partly on imagination and memory, the capacity to imagine other worlds, they can, with no problem, include the dead ancestors and gods, as well as living roles holding the members of essentialized groups like tribes and nations. Finally, we can understand religion as the product of still more basic principle, which Marshall Shallins in his analysis of kinship called the mutuality of being. The mutuality of being. The idea that humans, and from a religious perspective, non-humans and superhumans are members of another who participate intrinsically in each other's existence. Kinship becomes just one expression of this mutuality, with religion another wider expression. No surprise then that religious beings are often identified by kinship idioms like mother or grandfather. Of course, even this conception of religion does not solve all of our problems. There are other things, other beings, potentially real or mythical. Say extraterrestrial vampires or Santa Claus. They are not classified as religious. The lack of any sharp line separating religion from non-religion, together with the stunning diversity of religions, has caused some scholars, including religious studies scholars, to pronounce that there is no such thing as what? Religion. I'm already back. He says, together with the stunning diversity of religion has caused some scholars, including religious studies scholars, to pronounce that there is no such thing as religion. But this may go too far. And just because there is no such thing, no single bounded entity as religion, does not mean that there are no religions. Religion may be a fuzzy category that exists ambiguously in some cases, ambiguously in others, and not at all in still others. Man, she wasn't gonna do none of that, bro. She was too focused on arguing from ignorance. She does a really good job of arguing from ignorance. Not really good job. Her source, you know, I'm not gonna get into that. I said I wouldn't attack her methodology. Assuming we have permission to proceed with the study of religion, perhaps, It is more profitable to consider what religion does. So we can ask, what is the function of religion? Why do humans have such a thing, and what does it do for them? Of course, a member might answer that we have religion because it is true and because we are kinds of beings who can perceive or receive truth. This is not very helpful from an anthropological viewpoint, especially since different societies have perceived or received such different truths. No doubt there is something exceptional about humans that makes it possible and necessary for us to have religious notions, but let us set aside questions of truth and concentrate on social and cultural nature and functions of religion, which include filling individual needs, especially psychological or emotional needs. Religion can provide comfort, hope, perhaps love, definitely a sense of control and relief from fear and despair. Explanation, especially for causes. Humans wonder why things are as they are. How did the world start? How did humans start? How did society start? Most religions not only explain cosmogony, the creation of the world, but the origin of specific cultural institutions like marriage, language, technology, politics, and the like. Religions also explain why things happen in the present. Why do we get sick? Why do we bad things happen to us? Why do we die? In some societies, much, if not all, of sickness and misfortune is attributed to spiritual rather than natural causes. Sources of the rules and norms of religion can also provide the answers of where the traditions and institutions of the society came from. All religions contain some component of order, establishment, or cultural founding. This is the character function of religion. It acts as a character or guideline of authority by which we organize ourselves in particular ways and follow particular standards. Why monogamy? Because of superhuman being order, or because of the first humans of the present, etc. Why king? Because of superhuman being ordained the office of a king, or because the kings are chosen by superhuman being or possess superhuman force, etc. Source of ultimate sanctions. Religion is, among other things, a means of social control. Even in the Judeo-Christian traditions, a large part of the religion is about what we should do, how we should live. Politics and even kinship provide a measure of control. However, the limitations of political social control is to a scope. Human agents of social control cannot be everywhere, cannot see everything, and the rewards and the punishments that they can mete out are finite. For instance, they cannot continue to reward or punish you after you die. But religious sanctions can be much more extensive, exquisite, and enduring. In other words, religious beings and or forces not only make the rules, but enforce them too. Solutions of immediate problems. If religion is called a variety of human ills, then religion can be the solution as well. If we are all sick or distressed of being the forces of causing it, what should we do about it? If there is an important social and political decision to make, say going to war, is there a way to discover the preferences and plans of being and forces to read their mind? Can we ask them for favors, give them gifts, or do anything at all to influence their actions and intentions? This is crazy. Spiritual beings having a human experience. Filling collective needs beyond the individual who compose society or the individual needs, it is impossible to view the society as an entity in its own right. With its own high level, certainly not everything that a religion teaches or practices is beneficial for every individual. Human sacrifice does not fulfill the needs of sacrificial victims, nor does religion always soothe individual fears and anxieties. For instance, the belief is a punitive afterlife may render people more fearful, and concerns about proper conduct of rituals or about witches can add anxiety. However, belief in a punitive afterlife or witchcraft can compel people to obey norms, which is good for society. The primary need of a society, apart from the part of the odds with the needs of individual, is integration, cohesion, and perpetuation, and religion can provide an important glue towards the end. Studying religion anthropolitically. Anthropology as a science has carved out for itself a territory to investigate, and that territory includes all of human behavior in its dazzling and bedeviling diversity. Religion falls within that territory. But what precisely does anthropology hope to accomplish? What does it mean to study religion or anything else from an anthropological or a scientific point of view? The one thing it does not mean is to acquire a religion, to convert one, to become a member of a functionary of one. Candidates from the priesthood study religion, as do theologians, but their interests are to represent and defend one religion, to believe more deeply and convince others to believe in it, which cannot be the interest of anthropology. What anthropology, like any other science, ultimately wants to do with its chosen subject matter is to explain it. We can describe and catalog religions, but at some point we want to advance explanation. No longer content with definitions, what is religion, or cross-cultural descriptions. How many kinds of religions are there? We move on to question, why is religion? One obvious answer is because it is true, or because God, the gods, put it in us. These are answers with which anthropology or science in general cannot be content. The ultimate goal of scientific explanation is a theory. A theory orient us to the data in a particular way. What are the most important and irreducible or universal elements to look for? What relationship are they in with each other? And how do they interact to produce the facts under investigation? I told you this is a good book. A theory ought to offer us a model with some specific mechanisms or processes that gives us, that gives rise to and shape phenomena. It also ought to make some predictions which are testable in some ways, allowing us to potentially to verify or falsify the theory. It should therefore promise the possibility of using it to acquire further knowledge and understanding, as well as eliminating error. Anthropologists and other scholars of religion have constructed a variety of theoretical perspectives, each productive and each limited in its own way. No single theoretical perspective, like no single definition, can probably ever capture the entire essence of a nature of religion. Above all, we should avoid reductionism. The impulse and explanation explain religion in terms of reduced it to a single non-religious cause or basis. Rather, the cause of a basis is psychological, biological, or social. At the same time, we cannot help but notice that significant anthropological theories of religion often find the reason of explanation for the religion in non-religion. I ain't gonna go too far. They got some stuff in here about Molly. Watch this. You see Charles Darwin name, sure. Watch this. Let me pull up the thing on Molly. Boom. 64 instances on Molly. So the structure of the book, let me skip past that. I'm trying to go deal with the whole name. Boom. Religious language, words of truth, words of power. Told y'all to get Molly in. They did, man. The author deals with this on different levels. It's a good book. I will share it with y'all, but you know what I'm saying? Last time I shared some books with people, they ain't read them. So we couldn't build on the book and we couldn't obtain the information on it the way it needed to be. And just because people don't agree with you don't mean people are sensitive. I think that you got sensitive because there was an opposing view that actually exposed your methodology and the flaws in your presentation, and you got in your feelings. Y'all don't agree with me on this show. They sensitive. We would do another. You know what I'm saying? You had to say all of that. That's dumb. I dropped a link in the chat for you to come and try to argue whatever it is you wanted to argue. But what you did was you ran talking about you going to do a show. We don't agree with you over here. This, that, and the third. We don't agree with your presentation because the way you presented it. The information in your presentation doesn't substantiate your position. You didn't demonstrate how the Declarations of Innocence was a religion. The emphasis and the focus is on how you define religion. Did nobody block him? What are you talking about? The emphasis and focus, and the person that agree with you is the same person that's in your chat. Anybody that come with your chat that agree with you is pseudo as hell already from the gate.
And he ain't never presented no information. He always provides his opinion. And he's in everybody chat, providing opinion, never comes on, does any presentations, provides any sourced information, but his opinion. So miss me with that bullshit. You defined religion using these little mere definitions, and then you never showed how the 42, as you say, the negative confessions, but I say the real word, declarations of innocence, fit the definition. You think because there's a Rodnu Peretz Amheru that they was out there publishing books. No, this is not no fucking Bible. And you can't find me people worshiping the declarations of innocence, venerating the declarations of innocence, praying to Ma'at, and doing all these other things because she didn't have an occult following. She only had a temple. It was incarnate. And it came way later. So all of this, you running down trying to say this, that, and the third, you did not. You didn't. How the fuck did you do that? What did I miss something in your presentation where you defined religion and then went and showed how the declarations of innocence was a religion? They ain't even defined by that bullshit that you put on the screen. I don't know who you talking to. So while you sitting here saying all these other things, you did not demonstrate that. You can't find me in all the 42 gnomes, a group of people that were worshiping Ma'at, the declarations of innocence, venerating the declarations of innocence, ritualizing the declarations of innocence, or any of that stuff. Because all of that had to do with you personally in your afterlife. And everything in the existence in the natural world had everything to do with law. And it was emphasized, law, justice, reciprocity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You didn't argue it accurately. And that's just bullcrap. Exactly, Sutek. When someone don't rock with your view and deal with what they deal with, then all of a sudden it's this, that, and the third. I don't even know why you came on here. Unless you got some evidence to show me people in Egypt worshiping the declarations of innocence, I don't even want to hear it.
All right. Hello? Can you hear me?
You can be heard.
Okay. So what'd you say now? Because I keep hearing you making these claims that I didn't make and putting them on me, and then
I never said nothing
about it being like Jesus, having a Bible, being canonical. I literally said in my presentation that it was not a religion.
You said it's a religion.
Yes, but that doesn't have anything to do with Jesus or being canonical or any of that.
Demonstrate it.
What are you talking about?
Demonstrate it.
Demonstrate what I already did. I made a whole.
No, you did not. I don't think that you understand. You did not. You presented information, but you did not demonstrate how the declarations of innocence was a religion.
So in the beginning, when I unpacked what I said, right? What did I say?
I'm finna show you.
I said that.
Let me show you.
Oh, there you go. Oh, I can hear you. Okay, when I unpack what I said that it was that the Egyptians, that they were religious, and that this Maya and the 42 laws of Maya was part of that. That's the reason why I said polytheistic. You all want to say that they weren't religious because they did not have the word religion and concepts of religion at the time. Neither with the Hebrews. The Hebrews wouldn't say they're religious.
No.
You know what I'm saying? Neither with the Greek. The Greek wouldn't say they were religious. But knowing what we know about religion,
there's no consensus on a definition, and everything doesn't fit into the landscape of someone's definition. So you can't impose a definition on a people who it don't, it ain't
intended. So what you're saying is that religion does not exist.
What I just told you is that you can't superimpose a definition on a people that ain't even a defining.
Okay, so what you're saying is that religion does not exist. That's your stance.
What I am telling you in the scope of what I just said, as it pertains to Africans, it doesn't exist. It's not in their languages. We can't find the word.
It's not in nobody's languages that we call religion today.
Who? Say what?
It's not in their languages because it wasn't religion. It was their culture.
It's in French.
Those Israelites, those Israelites would say that's their culture. We call it a religion. The Greeks would say that's their culture. We call it a religion. Egyptians would say that's their culture. We call it a religion.
Denise.
Yoruba would say that's their culture. We call it a religion. West Africa would say it's their culture. We call it a religion.
No, it ain't.
Voodoo is not a religion, is it? No, yes, it is. But they're not going to say it's a religion.
It's not. How can you define shit that you don't know nothing about as a word that you can't even properly define?
People, you don't like religion. That's your issue. Your issue is just with the word in itself.
No. Your issue is you're trying to define some shit that you don't even know nothing about.
What? No, it's not. Your whole problem here that you're telling me is that religion in itself, the word, the concept, the everything, right? That is something that you're saying is basically just made up, which it is. Every single word is just made up, right? So it was something used to define something in certain cultures. Although those cultures would not say that that's religion. They would say it's just their cultural things that they do, traditions, beliefs, or whatever.
What is a religion?
Jesus.
Give me the definition. I define religion
in a million different ways. It has a lot of different definitions.
No. Yeah, 17, and nobody agrees on any one of the motherfuckers.
They do agree. They agree on something.
No, tell them they don't agree. I just basically showed it. They don't agree. They don't agree. So what I'm telling you again is these people who made
no such thing as religion.
So I'm gonna say it real slow for you. The people who created the definition for this word that you're using, that you're stuck on, never had Africa in mind. Never had Africans. Ask Africans. And that's why anthropologists said that word probably don't even take a meaning all over the world. It only means something to the people it was referring to. And your whole thing was trying to bring.
What are you even talking about, man? You went so far back in anthropology, it's ridiculous. And you can update your thought process and your sources so that you can understand what anthropology
is. My anthropological work is
because how do we learn?
In 2022, my anthropological work is from 2021. So how did I go so far?
It's old. What you're saying, like you just said, you said something about it. It needs.
You don't even know.
They took that out of the definition a minute ago, right?
I just gave you a fucking source from last year. How the fuck is it old?
I can give you a source from last week. And what does this
you
mean?
Can't give me a source.
That the information is not old.
You can't give me a question. I gave you an anthropological.
This was horrible.
dealing specifically with the word religion.
It's okay. You don't like the word religion.
No, it has nothing to do with the word religion.
So, is Christianity a religion?
You did not define it. You at all. You took after. This is what you did.
No. You just agreed with my definition.
I ain't on your show. You took the word and the definition and you imposed it on Africans.
Oh, Jesus.
Did you not?
No, I didn't.
Okay, so you didn't.
I didn't impose it on Africans.
Oh, no. Hold on. No. Don't say less. Say less.
Hello. I am Denise. And today I am going to do a presentation about Maya. It's about...
Hey, real quick, Henry, you should shut the fuck up right now. I don't even know why. I do know why you're here. But you should shut up. 25 times, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about.
Basically, the fact that I said that it was a religion.
The introduction.
And I'm dealing with those statements right now. I'm dealing with that. One second. Let me make sure that this is working before I continue. We see they're circled. So one of them, I said, Maat is a belief system in and worship of a superhuman. What is religion? There is so many different definitions of religion. We have religion, the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods, a particular system of faith and worship. Dictionary.com says a set of beliefs concerning the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe, especially when considered as the creation of a superhuman agency or agencies, usually involving devotional and ritual observances, and often containing a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. Wikipedia says that religion is...
Hold on, so let's run it back. She says, based on these, what she looked up in Wiki and screenshotted, the belief in and worship of superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods. So show me the declarations of innocence being a god or gods, or fitting that definition. Okay, so it doesn't fit this definition. Hold on. Mind your business. I'm finna go all the way to work. I'm finna go all the way to work. So now, here comes pettiness. So, the Declarations of Innocence, she says, is a religion. The first definition says the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods. The Declaration of Innocence doesn't fit that definition. Let's go next. A particular system of faith and worship. So you having morality is considered a system of faith and worship? Is that what you're arguing? A pursuit of interest to which someone ascribes supreme importance. Is that what you're trying to define it as? Let's go next. Definition of religion: a personal set of institutionalized system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices. The Declaration of Innocence deals more with your morality and personal conduct than anything else. You're dealing with yourself. This ain't something that you go to service on. This ain't something that you dealing with. And then where you're ascribing it from, the Declarations of Innocence can only be found in a couple of places. It's only a couple of places. It's not everywhere. So once you understand where those places are, which you didn't show, you only mentioned the Book of the Dead, which you know it by. Meant that you're handicapped on the subject matter. Next, religion.
a set of beliefs concerning the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe, especially when considered as the creation of a superhuman agency or agencies, usually involving devotional and ritual observances, and often contain a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. I'm telling you from the gate that they are not thinking shit about Africa. This ain't the only time that we said this. There's a whole presentation and a book coming in regard to this whole word. Because once upon a time, the wiki article that you have on religion called African Traditions and Customs Folk Religion, they removed it from folk religion in the last year and changed it to African Traditional Religion. So now the wiki article reads that African traditional religion is one of them subfields of religion on down in the Wikipedia article. But in this same article, she read this whole thing and didn't even emphasize. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. So where do we get the word African traditional religion from? We don't get it from Africans. We get it from Geoffrey Perringer, a white man. Geoffrey Perringer. He doesn't even consult with scholars on the continent. He just creates his own term. When did he create his term? He introduced this term in 1954. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm getting back to my art, but I just want to show you where the wiki article is. Boom, there you go. When this definition is written, they're telling you what they're referring to. They're going to tell you. There are an estimated 10,000 distinct religions worldwide. About 84% of the world population is affiliated with Christian, Islam, Hinduism, and Buddhism, and some folk religion. Now, I just told you that they took Africa up out of folk religion. Africa used to be in folk religion. We got the presentation with the screen to show what we documented, where it was under folk religion. So now they got this version, and then they got folk religion. But when you go down here and look at specific religions, they get specific. Abrahamic, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, other. East Asian. Taoism, folk religion. Oh, what is folk religion? Chinese folk religion, the indigenous religions of the Han Chinese. So now they got this Chinese, Philippine, and all this stuff. Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism. They calling all of that folk religion now. They're going to East Asian. They run it down. All of this, indigenous and folk. Then they go traditional African. They run it down. Watch this. Watch. Hold on. No, I gotta go back in the article. And now let me get to the African traditional religion. Traditional African. African traditional religion. You click on it and you go where you go. And then they give you this rundown. This word was introduced to people in 1954 by a white guy. The concept was new and radical when G. Perringer introduced it in 1954 and later developed by two people, Adewo and MB, would take up the personages of the words because it made more sense to them, and it didn't have that negative light the way the other one did, because they used to call things paganism and heathenism when they referred to African traditions. I talked to Unc Banu about this one time, and he gave me his perspective on it and why he liked the word ATRs. Back when they were talking about Kimoyo early on, but that would be Fukiao when he dropped that Kimoyo on people. But
But this was never, once again, this whole notion of African customs, traditions, all of that stuff is not properly defined by the people who are actually throwing it at you. Because look, in this definition of what ATRs are, the traditional beliefs and practices of African people are high diversities that include various ethnic religions. Generally, these traditions are oral rather than scriptural and passed down from one generation to another through folk tales, song, and festivals. Include belief in the amount of a higher and lower gods, sometimes including a supreme creator or force, belief in spirits, veneration of the dead, use of magic, and or traditional African medicine. Most religions can be described as animistic, polytheistic, pantheistic. The role of humanity is generally seen as one of harmonizing nature and the supernatural. Now, you can go through here and you can look at all these different definitions and deal with it. But they try to box it in. Adherents of traditional religions in Africa are described in 43 countries, are estimated a number over 100 million. Although most Africans today are adherents to Christianity and Islam. So let's stop right there. This whole theistic perspective, this theistic perspective comes from missionaries of Abrahamic faiths. These people don't know nothing about theistics. They don't even use the words gods. We're using these words to and imposing them on Africans, but the way they deify and look at things is totally different. This would require you to actually sit your ass down, read and study. So here go the thing. This dude said the Egyptians wrote shit down, right? So go show me the word religion in Ronnie Kimmett. Go show me the word. Since you said they wrote shit down, you can't read it. Go find me the word, Henry, religion in Ronnie Kimmett, in Egyptian spoken language. Go get the word. Go get the definition. Go get what they call, whatever they call they shit. Go find the word. You go tell me what the Egyptians call they shit. Oh, now religion. No, religion ain't an English word, bro. I just went through the whole total etymology of the fucking word. It ain't an English word. It derives way before English. It's Latin. Just like God is dramatic. We're imposing all these foreign words on Africa because we don't want to understand it. But for us to have a conversation, we use these words to make it make sense to people today so they can be like, oh, okay, so you're saying this. Because if I just stuck to the show and y'all never knew what Netaru meant or Nature meant, and I just said that the whole entire show and you were unfamiliar with those words, you wouldn't know what the hell I was saying. The English equivalent would be blah, blah, blah. I would have to say that to you. If I said Orimula, Odudewa, Shango, if you were unfamiliar to who those deities were, and I would have to say these were a part of the Yoruba pantheon of deities. Then you'd be like, oh. What we do in these arguments is we fight to include the English equivalent to a word that really doesn't have an English equivalent for. That's why I said I could have went with linguistics and I did not, because we won't find the words. We have books that tell us this. We have dictionaries, we have these texts from the continent
that tell us that there's no English equivalent for the word. I'm gonna give you a doubtful. So, among the Igbo, after God is Dibia, with Igbo Dibia, a terminology which does not have an English equivalent in Ogwu Igbo divination and their associate practices and wisdoms, all of which are well kept and jealously guarded secrets of Igbo Dibias. The word Dibia has no English equivalent. Just that quick. I just gave you an example of us trying to use an English word to define Dibia. And there's many others if I go to each cultural, if I go around the continent. We got to slow down. You can't extract the declarations of innocence out of the book of the Rahu Parit M. Heru, the book of coming forth by day and by night, and the judgment scene up out of the Rahu Parit M. Heru, and then say that's a religion. You have to demonstrate. So now you're imposing a definition that you're trying to insinuate has an equivalent in that culture, and then you don't argue it with evidence. For instance, if I was to argue that the Declarations of Innocence was a religious practice, I would have to go and show. So what you're going to do is say, well, the Bible's got some of these similarities, and you're gonna go all the way back to the pseudo-Judo and use the whole other thing. No, I don't know what you're gonna do. I really don't even give a damn. But my whole point is, I'm not listening to none of the foolishness. None of it. Zion said, the search not found. And now you got an issue. A key characteristic of theism is that the big deity intervenes in earthly affairs and maintains a relationship with his subjects. Guess what? In African traditions, in African Kimoyo, the big deity does not intervene in human affairs. I repeat, if you go all around the continent and you look at their cosmology and cosmogony and you get into their traditions and culture and they start naming who they deify and how it is exemplified and so forth, none of those deities participate or are involved in human affairs. They ain't involved in human affairs. So now you just said religion based on this, and then you just said this and this and this based on that. Now it's shrinking. The generalization shrinks, but they ain't going that far, Sute, because we already been on this years ago. And that's one of the motivations for why Panther has to drop the work that he's finna drop, is because people are misrepresenting African traditions and customs off the muscle. They so quick to look for English, Latin, French, Dutch, Germanic equivalent. Arabic, wasting time. Just slow your roll down. Go show me these motherfuckers in Egypt worshiping Ma'at, venerating Ma'at, feeding Ma'at, sacrificing Ma'at. They don't read the entire definition. That's how I know that they ain't researching. Man, they cherry picking their arguments, bro. They cherry picking their arguments. Then they want to come over here and act like they know shit. They don't know nothing. They ain't studied nothing about ancient Kemet. Everything they doing is right now on a Google search. No books, no studying the language, nothing. But finna sit up here and tell me what something mean, and they ain't even broke it down. The word is telling on itself. He caught you slipping, Henry, twice, real quick. Just when you was throwing out something, real quick. You only reading what you want to read to argue. You ain't reading what you're supposed to read to know. You don't. I have no respect for that. I don't have patience for that. See? She's still over there. She don't know what the fuck she's talking about. She's just talking and talking and talking and talking and talking and talking. Yes. This boy here crazy. How does it feel to be a public school teacher, Sean? Yo. Yeah, it's comical. But Sutek is killing it. Belief in the existence of a god or gods, especially belief in one god as a creator of the universe, intervening in it and sustaining a personal relation to his creators. You is tripping. You tripping. You tripping. Y'all ain't even going all the way there. Y'all ain't going all the way there, man. You ain't. They tell you in the Wicked article that you used as one of your screenshot clippings, but you didn't want to read the rest of the Wicked article. Maybe it was too much to read. It was just so much going on that you just didn't really want to deal with it. Buddy keeps saying it's an English word. No, I told you Latin. It's a Latin word. And then it really don't get no meanings until later on. And then you try to use that same word that these people that don't know nothing about African traditions and customs that come in the 14th, 15th, and 16th centuries and start imposing their ideology on Africans. In the West, in the Central, in the East, in the South, they were already imposing themselves when they was already ransacking Egypt during the Ptolemaic periods, the Greco-Roman eras. But y'all, you surface level. Hold on. So you said that I didn't deal with any of your claims? I absolutely did. I broke religion all the way down. How could you sit here and insinuate that I didn't deal with any of your claims? I broke religion all the way down. Like, is you, okay, I know what this is. This is the detracting method to get me to try to say something so that you can do a YouTube clipping so that you can go back and so that you can insinuate something. Look. I define religion for like 10 slides. Let me stop right here. Look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. How many slides? 10. How many slides? 11. How many slides? 12. How many slides? 13. How many slides? 14, 15, 16. Slides defining religion just so you could properly understand the extent of the word and its definitions and its importance. I did that. And then I transitioned right on into your other argument. You said my art was a religion. Based on the definitions and the etymology of the word, because that is what I did for those 15 slides, is I defined religion. See, this is how I know you don't understand. This is how I know that you don't understand research methodology, is because the first thing that I did was define the word and its etymology, setting up my argument to transition into your argument about my art being a religion. Once I've properly defined it, and once I've made it clear, then I can go in and make and do what I do. So then I begin to define my art, laying out the rest of the argument and defining my art, and giving a little historicity of my art and nice things to know. And then referring to other underworld texts that you never brought up or mentioned, because you don't know. And then I went into the Book of the Dead, which you went into the Book of the Dead, and I basically told you, Denise, what about the other 36 plates? You only dealt with, 35 plates. You only dealt with basically two plates. What about these other plates? How could you leave out the other plates? They're just as equally as important as the judgment scene and the declarations of innocence. That's basically what I'm saying right here in short. Then I just run down my conclusions to you. So for you to sit here and insinuate that I didn't deal with anything, I dealt with everything. What I didn't do was go through there and play tag with you on some stuff. I provided my hypothesis. I gave an introduction, a basic definition, provided my hypothesis, and then began my argument by making clear what was what. See, my methodology won't allow me to fall into a trap and not do what I'm supposed to do in an actual argument. This is what you did, Denise. It's the 8 minute and 58 mark. You didn't start with no damn definition. You 8 minutes into your shit. You didn't start with no definition. This is what you started with. This is where you started. Let's deal with my statements. You had some technical issues up here a little bit earlier. You were trying to talk about some little things. You tried to tell everybody that they need to go over there and get with Science with Sean, because there's a whole lot of science over there and the whole nine yards. But you didn't want to deal with the real work because you don't know how. You didn't define it. Look, this is your way of defining religion, right? This is your way of putting screenshots of definitions of religion on here. Let's take a look at these definitions and make some qualifying markers. So you're going to use Wiki to qualify your argument for a religion. And Wiki just told you that there's no consensus. There's no scholarly consensus over the precisely constitutes what a religion is. And you used it any damn way when Wiki told you off the muscle that it ain't no damn scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. You killed yourself in your own screenshot, and you finna sit here and tell me that you argued that you defined religion? Then you went on to talk about theism a little bit. I don't know what you, your qualifying markers of religion. Look at that. Belief in or concern with an afterlife. Well, my art or the declarations of innocence. How you want to argue that? You really didn't set up an argument for the declarations of innocence. The presence of theism. We don't even know what theism is. You never defined it. Offering sacrifices. You just throwing stuff out there. Holy place, temple, land building. The halls of Ma'at wasn't even a holy place. It was a temple. Designated to commemoration. So let me make that make sense to people out there. So listen, if you got anybody dead in your family and they got a tombstone at a graveyard that's in a park, that's a holy place or a temple. It's a land. It's a place. It's a place where land is. With a tombstone on it. If you go there and talk to the tomb, the headstone, if you go there and pour out some liquor, if you go there and smoke your blunt, if you go there and leave like a snack, if you go there and put flowers there, you are participating in a religion. This nigga just said I'm lying hard. This how dumb. Look, now he may not talk to me. Hold on. Let me not say anything. So, all right. Let's go. This is for the dummies that don't know how research methodology works. She plays a video by me. I skipped all of that for a reason. She plays the video by me, right? So she plays the video and then she comes to the definitions. Now listen to what she says specifically.
What is religion? There is so many different definitions of religion. We have religion, the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods, a particular system of faith and worship. Dictionary.com says a set of beliefs concerning the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe, especially when considered as the creation of a superhuman agency or agencies, usually involving devotional and ritual observances, and often containing a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. Wikipedia says that religion is usually defined as a social cultural system of designated behaviors and practices, morals, beliefs, worldviews, texts, sanctified places, prophecies, ethics, or organizations that generally relates humanity to supernatural, transcendental, and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
Say it again for me, Denise. Say it again.
Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
Say it again.
That generally relates humanity to supernatural, transcendental, and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
Say it again, Denise.
Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
One more time for Henry.
Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
Maybe he didn't hear you again because he's too busy typing.
Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
One more time.
Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
One more time.
Elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
Boom. So there's no consensus over what constitutes a religion, huh? There's no scholarly consensus over what constitutes a religion, huh? So, attempts to define religion have proved to be controversial and contested. There are many competing definitions by scholars and judges, but no consensus has emerged. There are at least 17 definitions of religion, and scholars may never agree on any essentialist definition. The problem of defining religion is not without real consequences, not least for questions of whether specific groups can obtain legal recognition as religions. Ideally, a guide to nature and history of philosophy of religion would begin with an analysis of definition of religion. Unfortunately, there is no current consensus on a precise identification of the necessary and sufficient conditions of what counts as a religion. We therefore currently lack a decisive criterion that would enable clear ruling whether some movements should count as religion. Among non-legal scholars in philosophy and religion, there is a lively debate as to whether the word religion can or should be defined. It has been observed that the effort to define religion is as old as the academic study of religion itself. In fact, dozens, if not hundreds, of proposals have been made, each claiming to solve the definitional problem in a new and unique way. Needless to say, no one definition of religion has garnered a consensus, and the definitional enterprise, as well as the debate over the very need for definitions, continues in full vigor. Attempts to define religion may have been controversial and contested. Many competing definitions. I'm all over you. Look what he says. Many competing definitions have been proposed by scholars and judges, but no consensus has emerged. This is over and over and over. Let us begin by recognizing that definitions are not real things. They are human and therefore cultural creations and categories, not natural facts. For you to sit here and act like you kicking a natural fact is blasphemous. A definition is not true. It's only more or less inclusive and productive. A narrow definition excludes phenomena that would be included within a wider definition. For instance, if we were to define religion as belief in or God, we would be disqualifying as religion all of the belief systems that lack a single God, so very few belief systems would qualify. If we define it as a belief in gods, we would still be disqualifying the religions that contain no gods. By imposing one conception of religion on others, we would be defining them into non-religion, i.e. if you don't believe in a God, then you don't have a religion. The act of defining is an attempt to specify what is unique and distinct about the subject. I know what I'm talking about. It would be foolish to attempt to adjudicate between the definitions of religion. And this is what you're trying to do. You're trying to adjudicate between the difference, between the definitions of religion. You put five up. The last one is telling you ain't no damn real consensus on religion. Yet you don't even listen to it.
This over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. Transcendental and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. Spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
So when you go and make whatever argument that you want to make, your last words were, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. Yet you try to fit some shit that you don't even study or know about into a box that is defined by something that there is no consensus over what precisely constitutes as a religion. So you and your whole bar method crew sound crazy as fuck. But because, you know, I piss y'all off, you know what I'm saying? I piss y'all off, you're going to be in your feelings, and then you're going to feel like the people in the chat who don't agree with you either because you didn't argue your point still to this day, and only the dumbass dude thanks that you argued your point, and you didn't argue your point. Show me where Ma'at is properly defined by any of these definitions that you're using, and you can't, because you know why?
Structural elements, how organizations that generally relates humanity to supernatural, transcendental, and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
So you have to deal with that, because you just try to use three different definitions that you screenshotted and put on a slide and all of that. You know, we got to work on your presentations and you'll get there. Just got to continue to keep working power to whether you may be using at the time, but you'll get there, get some organization. As you've seen, mine is a little bit more cleaner than yours, but I have to show you how to do it so you know how to do it next time and make it look more presentable. But you just said right here. So now you got to go back in here and you have to hash all of these things out. So let's go a little bit step further, because you said I used an anthropologist criterion for this, that, and the third. So let's go find your anthropologist. You don't give me your anthropologist until the 17-minute mark. So now we have an anthropologist. So this slide is out of place because it doesn't add validity to your argument, because now you're trying to impose these other definitions on something and then trying to then move on and then come back to a definition. So your definitions was at the 853 mark, at the 838 mark, and at the 1726 mark. They out of order. And you use a source. I guess this is the source at the bottom. So let's pull it up. Clifford Geertz, 1966. I don't know how you said that I used something old. You used the 1966 source, and I brought out a 2021 on you. I brought out some updated information on you, and you finna say all of that. So now I gotta go. Now you really want me to go to work on you. Religion. Let me see if I can quick, fast find this. I don't even think this is even the source. See, this is what I gotta go do to find it. So this ain't the source. This ain't the source, ladies and gentlemen. Capping the rep. Religion as a cultural system. The thing says it is it, but hell, I gotta find where it say all of that that you said. I gotta really find this. Okay, this is probably where you got this bullshit from. Tandforlion.com, online.com. So look, let's see. And it's influence religious, here you go, boom. Here you go, this how she did it. Here you go. Religion as a cultural system. And religion, a cultural system, is blah, 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 a system of blah, blah, blah. At the core of this definition is religion consists of a set of interrelated symbols. Blah, 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 blah. Let's see. Can we get the whole article? Can we get the whole article? Can we get it? Nope. All righty. So we got half an article. We ain't got the whole article, so we can't see the dude's entire article. So Henry Munson Jr., he girts on religion theory and the practice. So now Henry Munson Jr. Henry Munson Jr. It ain't Geats. Henry Munson Jr. Girts on religion. Girts on religion. So it comes back to that, comes back to research. Let's see what Science Direct say. I'm trying to find the entirety of the article. So click first page to preview. All right, so they're only throwing out one page on this. Can I get next article is an issue? Okay, so they don't give me the whole article. I've already logged in, bro. Should have already been logged in the JSTOR. Clifford Geach's long-lasting moves motivation to medical concept. This is why you need to be around real researchers. You don't need to be in no group. You shouldn't be starting no group with a bunch of people that don't have no type of research methodology and don't know how to do something right. Because we would have stopped you from making all kind of errors. I'm looking for his entire, I'm looking for the entire article, not some clickbait. I told y'all, y'all be cherry picking this shit. Y'all do this all the time, man. Can't none of y'all stuff like, let me show you something. Let me show you something real quick. You see my source? Let me go back. Eller, 2007. That's a quote. But look, Eller, 2021, page 7. If you go to Eller's work, his 2021 work, which I also have listed in my descriptions back here in my sources, you're going to go directly to the page numbers. And it's going to and you're going to know exactly what the author said, and you'll be able to read everything he said. You see this right here? That's the whole book, third edition, Routledge. So now you have the whole book. You can go directly to the whole book and go directly to where I quote and read exactly what I quoted. You ain't got to go on no wild goose chase, because I stand on my information, and my information can stand scrutiny. And ain't none of y'all gonna be able to refute what the hell I'm saying. Straight like that. She expected way better. That she held up on a pedestal that was not deserved. You ain't even got no money. You right. You expected way better. Right. As the shit that I just presented right here did not just kill your arguments. You can't even get around nothing that I actually said, because you don't know what the hell you're talking about. So it would only be right for someone who do surface level research, not even surface level research, someone who Googles to argue, to say some of the things that you actually said. You're not insulting me. You're insulting yourself. Because people who are unfamiliar to this entire argument are going to look at what you basically showed and then be like, well, she didn't present an argument. She said some stuff, she mentioned some stuff, but she really didn't present an argument. I can't even qualify your source. Because you got a half a source. You don't even have the whole study of religion. This right here is a half. I don't know who gave you this bullshit. Craig or that Henry dumbass. But you gave us half a source. Look, this is what you gave us. Half a source. We can't even get the whole source. We don't even know. Let's see what he says in the introduction. In his influential essay, Religion as a Cultural System, which was first published in 1966, Clifford Geertz argues that religion should be studied as a symbolic system in terms of which believers interpret the world and live their lives. See, now let's go back. You omitted, right? You omitted certain things. So let's see what you omitted, since you didn't want to go there. While endorsing this general approach to religion, and much of what Geertz has said about the study of culture in general, I shall argue that in his own ethnographic writings on religion, Geertz has often reduced the semantic substance of religion as a symbolic system to the overt appearance of behavior and personality traits as they appear to an external observer. This reductionism, I shall argue, is related to Geertz's tendency to interpret meaningful action without adequate attention to the structures of meanings in terms of which it is understood by the actor. The study of the symbols in the context of the symbolic systems of which they are a part, as advocated by Geertz is in his early writings, and their study in the context of ongoing pattern of life, as advocated by Geertz in his later ones, are complementary and equally indispensable aspects of an attempt to understand a religion from the believer's point of view. While Geertz's theoretical statements sometimes suggest that he realizes this, his ethnographic writings are often suggest that he does not. So it's a shot at Geertz. So you use this dude and you don't even understand that there's an argument being mounted against religion as a cultural system. He's telling you here. Henry Munson Jr. is telling you here that he is arguing against this 1966 bullshit. Craig did this. Look at him. He is still on surface level research. Henry, bro, listen to me, man. This is sad, bro. You see this book? It's called Beautiful Lessons of Kimoyo. It's written by Kofi Paisai. You see this? You see this book, right? Beautiful Lessons of Kimoyo. You see the back of the book. The purpose of this publication is to help those understand African traditional religion, or what we call it today, Kimoyo. In each chapter, the reader will learn about a different element that makes up Kimoyo. Anytime we learn about our ancestors' way of life, accomplishments, greatness, good deeds, and contributions they made to the world are being beautiful lessons which inspire the name of this publication. That whole word that you just threw out there, animus, just let me know that you still stuck, bro. You don't even know what these people call the traditions. You just talking shit. Now you on here arguing about belief. Like, I don't care. She came on here saying something about Egyptian. I don't care nothing about no Egyptian beliefs. I don't even look at it like that. I studied Kemet for its greatnesses and how it lasted so long and the intricate pieces inside of that historic perspective that allowed me to learn more. I like the language. I love transliterating and translating text because it tell me when all y'all are full of shit, whether you're a Hebrew, Moor, and all the other things. He said, if it's talking about Kofi, he said, if it's talking about what you talking about, now it's BS. Nah, my guy. You see this book right here? This is BS. This is your man's. You interviewed him. You had him on the show. You're part of a group. Assemble with him. You're part of a debate group on Facebook. You have no relevance outside of your Facebook group. They know who you are. They don't know what you do. You don't participate in anything that has to do with any black people whatsoever. You have no scholarships nowhere. Nobody in Africa know who you are. Nobody outside of your 12 people know who you are. I don't even know why you even coming like that. You can't, you pseudo off the gate because you called a book something and never read the book. You had me on your show because I told you to send me the link and we was talking to Craig. I ain't been on your show but the one time. And that was to mess with Craig after his debate. So don't say all of that. I got more followers than, I don't give a fuck about no followers. I don't care nothing about no followers. Dude, do you not know who I am? I don't care nothing about no followers at all. You having followers don't mean nothing. The church got 7 billion or more followers. What does that mean? Does that make the church right? Does that make the church more relevant because they got more followers? Does that make the church more truthful because they got 7 billion minds? No, it doesn't. That's irrelevant. You ain't shit. Bro, you don't get no views over there. If that's the case, you got a whole bunch of followers and no views. Well, congratulations. Congratulations, my guy. I'm happy for you. I'm glad. But you in my chat. You ain't got to come here. Y'all get so caught up in likes and followers and views that it's really pathetic. Irrelevant, bro. These people don't know who you are. You ain't nowhere. You go somewhere, bro, they ain't gonna know who you are. I've been places where I wasn't even recognizing people and they come up and be like, hey, Sean. I'd be like, yo, what up, my guy? Boom, 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 boom. Like, I don't know who you are. You ain't autographing no books and sending it to people. Guess what, though? Let me leave you alone about that. Denise's daughter know who I am, bro. I bet you she don't know who you is. I just leave it right there. Lies. What's a lie? What's a lie? Okay, so if Chavis was in the chat right now, what Chavis would say to you is when we was in Atlanta, a dude he never seen before came to me, and I never seen before a person that came up to me. I only seen him on YouTube. Came up to me and was like, yo, Sean, what up, bro? I'm finna get your book, man. I need you to sign it for me. Because he knew who I was. I really didn't know who he was. I don't lie. So for you to insinuate anything is everything. You have no information. Now tell me I'm lying. I already corrected Denise once. Y'all really want to fight over this, I can correct you again. And I can go even deeper, but I didn't want to do all of that because you don't even understand the principles of my art. You don't even understand Egyptian culture. You can't read the language and you have no understanding of anything about Africa. You don't really even fuck with Africa like that. You think you're an Aboriginal at heart. I'm just being sarcastic right then and there. But you slow on the information. Bruh, you will stay up and read some wiki articles and try to Google and share some shit you don't know nothing about. I already caught you out there slipping once. You out there talking about viruses and you don't even know shit about viruses. Nothing at all. You did a whole show on Information Age about viruses and you and the person, Timothy, whoever he is, y'all sounded stupid as shit. And it's on this channel too. So I'm going to say it again. Ask Denise, does her daughter know me? Her daughter read my book. Her daughter had a conversation with me and I answered all her daughter questions. I don't think she know who you is at all. You can ask her that. Ask her. Ask her. Go get her. Hold on. We ain't got to play no games. Get her. Don't go mute, Denise. We know you in here. Go get your daughter. It's the weekend. Go get your daughter. She up. Let's get some straightening on here. Black Dixie. Uh-oh, I see y'all got some Nah, Sutek, to what you said earlier about the person that didn't like something, absolutely. Hold on, let me go over here where where my privacy at? Privacy. Let me unrestrict. Yeah, I know I don't care. What this mean? Go get your daughter. I'm finna end all this right now. I'm finna find out if her daughter, since you talk to her every day. Paul Wall? Okay, I'll ask him. Paul Wall don't know who you are. I'ma ask him. I'll ask Paul Wall. Why I gotta ask Paul Wall? Is it because you met Paul Wall or something? Are you in your feelings? Hold on, y'all. She don't know you. Dang, you talk to somebody every day, man, and their daughter don't even know you, dog. You talk to somebody every day and their daughter don't know you, dog. You talk to the same person every day, bro, and their daughter don't even know who you are, bro. Come on now. Dismiss yourself, man. Do yourself a favor. Hey, what's that word when somebody don't know that they're wrong? What's the word that JJ defined? I mean, is JJ all day? What's that word? Somebody got to give me the word. I know it's narcissism, but I really don't like using the word narcissism because that's what's going on right now. The niece is having narcissistic behaviors. You know what I'm saying? Because I was reading back some of the comments and things like that was actually stated. And she is of the belief that I waved some type of white flag. And she is of the belief that I some kind of did. So I don't know what she's thinking, but she don't realize that methodologically she really got embarrassed because it's a tale of two different presentations. And one is condensed with very little information that supports the argument and never makes an argument. You made a claim and never supported evidence of the claim, but you went back and did this. This is what's so funny about it. You wanted to change your argument and then try to say, ain't nobody dealing with your shit. See, I knew that was coming. I knew that was coming. And that's why I had the screenshots for myself, because I knew that I was like, when I do this presentation, she's going to say that was a mistake, that was not her argument. She was very clear. My eye is a belief system. It's a religion. She was clear. And then she goes back and says, my eye is a goddess. She double downs and says, my eye is a goddess and the laws of my eye is a religion. It takes you on the journey to where your heart gets weighed by Anubis. She was just messing stuff up. Chavis was trying to help her. My eye is a word with a bunch of different contextual uses. And that's why I tried to show her that Ma'at has many different contextual differences. We have the dictionaries and we know how to transliterate and translate the text to get us to where we need to go. She said Ma'at is a belief system. It's a religion. She said it more than once because Sutek up here says Ma'at ain't a belief system. She said it more than once. And then she tried to change her argument so she would leave herself wiggle room to get out of her bullshit. And this is why she started her presentation with this weak ass slide right here and try to say, well, I didn't mean this. I might have been typing too much or typing and listening. How you typing and listening, nigga? You on a panel. So you saying you ain't good at multitasking? Nah, something else. Go get your daughter. I don't care nothing about Egypt or Hebrews. I just know you can't argue information. You damn sure can't present it. But I'm not going to demean you for that. I'm going to give you a little bit of respect because you did a presentation. And that's all I'm going to do. I'm going to give you some, no matter how bad it was, I'm going to give you some credence because you did something. Go get your daughter. Tell her to hit the link. I want to talk to your daughter real quick. She got some sense. I see you, Pure Black. Right. Wusa, what you talking about? You going too far, because it ain't that serious to me. I'm just beating up your shit. Thank you. Look. When you put people in a box, this is how they respond emotionally. But yet they would insinuate that you're emotional because they will say things like this. You see what I'm saying? They will say things like this. I'm not even addressing you no more at this point. I'm going, you on mute. You're going to be irrelevant. Yes, you do. Go get her. See? You want to believe like the, this shows you how stupid you, well, let me take the bet. This shows how ignorant you are when you say stuff like this, because you ain't never seen or heard me do a show where I even leaned like I was religious in some type of way. Nah, don't do all that. Go get your daughter. Your man said he talked to you every day and he don't know who your daughter is. That's how clownish your chat is. Let me hold up. Let me just make myself clear. Let me make myself clear. Yeah, you and your feelings. Yeah, you and your feelings.
Devotional and ritual observations, observances, and often containing a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. Wikipedia says that religion is usually defined as a social cultural system of designated behaviors and practices, morals, beliefs, worldviews, texts, sanctified places, prophecies, ethics, or organizations that generally relates humanity to supernatural, transcendental, and spiritual elements. However, there is no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion. There's no scholarly consensus over what precisely constitutes a religion.
So how do you come to the conclusion that you don't even know what's going on in this scene right here? You don't know what's going on in this scene because you're not reading the text. You're not reading the text. You got a picture up here with where it's telling you what's going on, but you're ignoring what's being said. And then you opt in to, where did you get this source? Where did this source come from? Where did this come from? Where did you get this information that you copied and pasted right here and then take the back white off of it? Where did you get this from? What's the source for that? Then you went here, and this is when Kofi made his comment earlier on when I first made it. You showed the Budge stuff. Kofi was like, Budge, trash. And we got Budge's book. That's how we know it's trash. This information right here, where did you get this information? Is this from the wiki article? Where'd you get it? Because you don't say it at the bottom or insinuate it, anything like that. Then you start trying to qualify things that you don't have a command of. And you said nobody dealt with it. I dealt specifically with your qualifying claims verbally from the top. And then you use this little half argument that you Googled from somewhere, and then you didn't read the entire study. So you just try to find a portion of something to insinuate something to be supportive. What you did was biased research. You didn't do non-biased research, which makes your research that you did biased research and pseudo. You never answered the research questions. Is Ma'at a religion? Is the declarations of Ma'at a religion? Based on what criteria? And who was practicing this religion? Who was practicing the declarations of innocence as a religion? You didn't answer any of that. But you said that you're disappointed or whatever the case may be. It is what it is. You do whatever you want to. And you get this drunk ass nigga in the chat. She ain't got none. She ain't got nothing because I ain't brought out nothing. What she got? You ain't even seen what I really got. I just show a pinky and you think it's a hand. I can walk you right into where I want you to go. But the thing about it is I'm not even going to respond to her no more because her level of understanding information and how to perceive it and how methodology works is very minute. And I ain't got time for that. She need to go study up. It's a waste of my time to continue to respond to someone who ain't adding to scholarship. And I'm not going to do a back and forth on YouTube with irrelevant shit. And that's not to belittle her in any type of way, just the way I feel about what the subject matter is beneath me. I don't even talk about Kimmy no more. I leave that to all you culturalists. But you won't do nothing. That's Craig. He from Memphis, not that's Craig, pure black. That's him. He don't believe that Mississippi is Israel. He be saying that to antagonize the Hebrew people to be of that belief because that's what they be saying. But that's Craig though. Yep, he be on Garfield channel. But he don't want no smoke. Right. Craig be trying to gas up. Deal with it. Pseudo is here. But there's, you know, it was what it was. It's not really a big old thing to me. Like I said, man, I'm not wasting another day on it. You need to get your methodology accurate. You need to learn how to do PowerPoint. And you need to learn how to first read the whole page and not pieces of information. You can't surface level research a subject matter and then try to argue it like you have command of the subject matter. You have to go in and do the work. You made a claim and you didn't argue the claim that you made. In the very first slide, you ran from your claim. You said that Maat was a religion, and then you said the Declarations of Innocence was a religion, yet you didn't properly demonstrate that. And I don't know how you think you did that and assume that I didn't refute that. Yeah, you do, Craig. Yeah, you do, because you was Hebrew Craig for a while. You be saying that stuff. What you stealing, Sue Tech? Oh, the pie. Oh, you crazy. I see what you did right there. He said on fire. That went crazy. Ain't no politics, friend. Watch this. She done called everybody out. She want everybody to take her side. This how bad they want to catch me slipping, bro. They have designated hours to trying to figure out how to box me in so they can win an argument against me because I done went over there and they chat and beat up everybody in there or ran them away or made them shut up. Craig, your boy was on here saying that he had me on the show. I said, yeah, to interview Craig. Nigga, you ain't happen on no show to do no interview with me. You don't interview nobody but pseudos. I went over there to get a show some spunk. Craig, I ain't say you was no Hebrew. I said you had that shit in your name. So look, man, I dropped the link in the chat, Craig. You want some smoke? The link in the chat, Craig. You want smoke? I got about 5 more minutes, man. I've been playing too long. I really should have ended this mug about 2 hours ago, for real, after I presented. Yeah, Memphis had Hebrews a long time ago. In 2001, it was some Hebrews. Because my homeboy, who was an Israelite, I found out he was an Israelite in like 2001. And he was associated with some dudes out from Memphis who was Israelites too. And I ain't know nothing about no Sinetta, but I knew the cult, the Hebrew Israelite cult of the cult. Man, I ain't ate nothing today. I should have ate. Hebrews are deep out here in Bakersfield. Oh yeah, you're in Pseudoville. You about like Bar Method. Ain't number Pseudoville over there in Bar Method. That's where Craig reside. In Pseudoville. Oh, now you changing your argument. You see how sensational this Negro is? Now you changing this argument. Memphis never seen Hebrews like new wops. Come on, Craig. Quit changing your argument. 1 minute they ain't seen no Hebrews since Sinetta. Now they ain't seen no Hebrews like new wops. Make your mind up. He said Bar Method up, though. Pseudoville. Craig like the Bar Method because it make him feel like the smartest person in the room. She mad at me too. Okay. Be mad. I rock with your daughter though. Your daughter's a sweetheart. Very smart. She said, I thought, okay, so let me break it down real quick for you, Denise, because I know you still listening. All right, so when you say you define religion, right, and then you say that the Declarations of Innocence is a religion, you have to demonstrate that, and you did not do that. Defining something doesn't mean you demonstrated that. You have to go in and show and prove that this is the equivalent to this definition based on the evidence. You didn't provide any substantial evidence in your argument to show that the Declarations of Innocence was indeed the equivalent of this definition that you ended up saying when you read the re-order that there's no consensus on it. And it has issues, which is something that I basically told you from the earliest onset, is that you don't want to box African traditions in the same light and window as others. And you did it anyway, out of ignorance. And I try to tell you that there's shows on there going through this stuff. Bar Method has stupid people arguing over stupid stuff every day. Most everybody, 98% of the people that's back there arguing, Craig, ain't even read what they arguing about. I've caught so many people not even reading the information that they're trying to put out that it made no sense for me to be back there, bro. Mm-mm. That's not how scholarship works. So Denise thinks that I'm arguing something. This is what she said. You start arguing with yourself. No, I did not. I never argued with myself. It was made clear by watching your presentation that you didn't know what you was doing. You didn't, you used definitions, and then you claimed something to be a religion, and you never showed and proved how that is a religion. You failed in your demonstration. You just showed a bunch of defining words, but you never extracted and demonstrated. So there was nothing really to challenge outside the fact to properly define what this word religion, and then put it in a box based on what the anthropologists, social and culturally, say, and how no one agrees on this shit. And then turn around and clean up what Ma'at is. So she can't, I mean, she can do whatever she want to do, but if she thinks she's going to do an astrology presentation, that's what I'm saying. What are you doing all of these presentations for, and you don't study these subject matters? Like, you really, she making another mistake. It don't matter who helped her, bruh. She ain't got no evidence. And everything that she's going to pull out, we've already went through years ago. The Nerdy Bruce said, I talk to myself sometime. I need real nigga advice. Panthers like Hewitt P. He said, Panthers like mountain lions. But it goes over people's head, man. But it is what it is at this point. And, you know, I appreciate her doing what she's doing, but I don't care nothing about that. She got some stuff to work on. Hopefully she work on it. If she don't, then she don't. It is what it is. What's funny to me is that some of the information that I had was in a presentation that I did a long time ago, like years ago. Some of the references on the Ma'at side, I already had stuff on a lot of this stuff that y'all be talking about, Craig, back there, and you don't be telling them nothing. You just be letting them talk and put themselves in a corner. We already had discussions and presentations and information on it, and you still allow them to walk themselves into a corner, trap themselves, and then they get caught up in everything. And that's a mistake. Oh shit, what the hell Kofi talking about? Kofi talks about online friendships. What is a friendship? And is an online friendship genuine and authentic? Oh hell. Which I done did to Kofi. What y'all do to cover, man? Got the man talking about friendship and shit. I didn't kick you off. See, now you lying. I didn't kick you off. I just put you in the back room while I got to explain the stuff. I gave Craig the link. He didn't hop on. I ain't never kicked you off before, so don't sit here and insinuate that I just kick you off. I don't kick you off. I done had you on every time you done been on, you done been on through the whole entire show until it ended. So what make you think that I'm finna kick you off now? See, now there you go. There go them feelings. There go them feelings. There go them feelings. There go them feelings. No. If I'm trying to explain something so the audience can understand what I'm trying to explain, I'm not worried about how you feeling, because you and your feelings. You emotional. You tired of me making you apologize to me. Because you're uncomfortable with that. It gets on your nerves, and you don't like telling people when you're wrong. And you don't like admitting when you're wrong. You told me that. You want to fight. So don't pray.
Man, look, man, I ain't even gonna be on YouTube for a while. I got work to do, man. This half of here, boy. That was NGA debate. I don't associate with them. What? It was who debate? What up? Ain't nobody listening to all that. You didn't make anything interesting. The same people that was here was already here before you even came in the thing, bruh. You ain't made nothing interesting, man. Oh, okay, great. Well, stay on your call. Yeah, that's their partner right there. The confusion people. But look, man, I'm out, man. I appreciate everybody for tapping in. Might be a couple of weeks or so before I do anything. Unless science has its say. There was some other information that came out, but I'm just gonna sit on that for a little bit and see exactly where it goes. There's some studies and stuff that I'm trying to wait to get my hands on to see if I can dig into it, if it's worth digging into. And then go from there. So, you know, I'm keep it, like I said, always about the information. I ain't sweating nobody over there, man. Y'all be who y'all be, do what y'all do. I don't give a fuck what y'all do. But if it comes across me, if I feel like it's something I need to address, then I just take the gloves off all the way instead of like partially. And I just be a whole asshole. I don't mind being an asshole to people. But, you know what I'm saying? Hopefully, Denise, you learn something from how to present information and what it looks like to present information and how to follow a method so that you can be able to do the right stuff. Craig, you got to stop this dude. And he's gonna do a response video. You sleeping on her approach to info. She set you up with a short presentation because you trigger happy. Craig, you're incorrect. I'm on Denise Fire Craig. He led you into this. Craig, I'm not gonna acknowledge you no more in the chat. If you got something you wanna say, say it right now. Come on the link and say what you gotta say. Cause you sound crazy as hell, bro. I already know what type of people y'all got back there in that chat. None of y'all have any strategical moves that can counter anything that can be presented. All you can do is just, you know, try to draw something out, and I'm not going to allow something to be drawn out. You don't have a single primary source that would help support the claim that she made. So for you to insinuate that she did a short presentation because you trigger happy was crazy. I wasn't even addressing her. It just, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it's crazy almost. I can tell when you drunk, you drinking too damn much. You say the stupidest shit when you drunk. Like for real. I gave you, I don't know if you noticed, but the information that I had in there that was referring to comes from, you know, them pyramid texts, coffin texts, stuff like that. In reference to how my eye was seen and all of that, that's primary shit. But you wouldn't know that because none of y'all have actual books. Yeah, this is true. And this is what they get off on right there. Like, how do you educate people if y'all fighting?
That's how y'all know how to do a fight. Like, who's being edified in the fight? People got to go back and you know what I'm saying, deal with y'all bullshit over and over and over again, and y'all ain't even making no sense. That's a fact. Because they ain't reading, man. Henry showed y'all. He Googled. I'm telling you what he did. Henry Googled something real quick and then started copying and pasting it in the chat. And Sutek was using the same shit that Henry was Googling and putting it back in the chat, showing him that he ain't reading what the hell he Googled. That's a problem among all of them. And that's going to continue to be a problem among all of them. They have too many deficiencies. And one of their deficiencies is not reading, is the illiteracy. I ain't going to say they can't read. They know how to read. They just ain't going to do it. It's too time consuming. So they'll start, that's what she's talking about. They'll start a call on Facebook, a group call, and then they'll start arguing with one another. See? I can always tell when I did something, you know what I'm saying? When you know how you bruise somebody to the core, they just keep popping up, like they just said all of these things and then they just kind of slide off into the sunset and then they try to come back. What are you talking about, bro? What are you talking about? What are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about, Craig. Actually, you do. You do have an echo chamber. What you talking about? You picked the fight, though. So let's get info and methodology on. Craig, you don't have any info. And you don't have any methodology. What we gonna get on? What fight you want me to pick? Y'all don't have no information. I'm lost. I'm lost. This person is in their feelings, yo. It don't even matter what you do at this particular point. You can make an ass out of yourself. Come on. The chat already know you made an ass out yourself. Do we need to play all the apology videos or, you know what I mean, show where you apologize, the voice where you apologize? Okay, I was wrong. Okay, Sean, I was wrong. Nobody want to hear all this shit. Just go on about your business, man, end your day. You ain't got nothing else to do?
You've invested a lot in your education and people have invested in you. And let me tell you, the world needs your talents. Man, does it ever. The world needs a lot and we need it from you. We really do. We need it from you young people. I mean, I'm not speaking for the rest of us up here, but I know I'm getting a little grayer. We need it from you, the young people, because remember this. So you got to get out there. You got to give it everything you got, whether it's your time, your talent, your prayers, or your treasures. Because remember this, you will never see a U-Haul behind a hearse.
presence of a king. Scratch that, you in the presence of a god. Put in the belly of the beast. I escape, a nigga never had a job. Scott Forrest, you over, baby. Robinson Cano, you coming with me. These niggas like rotary phones. It's a new day, hit up KD. Niggas always try to knock a nigga down. Knock me to my knees about a million times. Uncle said I'd never sell a million records. I sold a million records like a million times. These niggas shouldn't let me in. I ball so hard on ESPN. See my name come across on CNN. About 6 minutes, you gon' see it again.
Get this work, nigga.
I killed you.
Hold up. We gonna get this work.